state capitol and the Coliseum nearby, filled to capacity tonight on a clear, cold night, 37 degrees, as the Tennessee Titans come out onto the Coliseum field. And the Titans tonight get ready to face the Kansas City Chiefs, and that means the great tight end Tony Gonzalez will be in action from Nashville on Monday Night Football. Al Michaels with John Madden, Michelle Tafoya, welcome to Nashville. And the way these two teams played last year, you'd have thought this would be a game with big-time December playoff ramifications. It is not. Each team is 4-8, and as usual, a combination of factors are the reason. Because when you take a look first at the Kansas City Chiefs last year, they scored a lot, but they couldn't stop you. Defense was the problem. They didn't fix it. This year, defense, again, the problem. Twice this year, they scored 30 or more points and lost the game. With Tennessee, if you had to point to one thing, it would be injuries. Now, I know every team has their share of injuries. Tennessee has had more than its share, and in particular, Steve McNair, who last year was the co-MVP of the league along with Peyton Manning. He's been in and out of the lineup. He'll be out again tonight. Billy Volek will get the start. Thus, both teams come in 4-8 as the season is now past the three-quarter mark. And, John, when you look at these coaches, Jeff Fisher and Dick Vermeil, they met in the Super Bowl 5 years ago. They've had tremendous success in recent years. But how do they now approach this game and the rest of the season?
You know, it's very tough on them. And you know, I mean, they're two coaches that are very good coaches, have been in a long time, have won, know how to win, know what it takes to win, and they're going through this season at 4-8. But don't you feel that just talking to both guys, that they've gotten over the disappointment, that now they're kind of fresh? I mean, you get the feeling, okay, they're 4-8, they're going to be jumping off bridges and stuff. But you talk to them, and I think what they do is just take them one game at a time. And you know that if there's a game to be played, there's only one way to play it, and there's only one way to coach it.
Each team, of course, can score. Neither team seems to be able to play defense. So do we see a pinball machine game tonight?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, as you said earlier, both teams have good offenses. They have no defenses. And I think they're going to pull out all stops. I mean, it's going to be a fun game. You look what Jeff Fisher did last week, 3 onside kick, you know, block punt, punt, a fake punt, all those types of things. He said last night he has 4 fake punts for this game, and I think it's going to be that type of game that there's going to be wide open, anything goes. What the heck? What are you worried about?
Virtual reality right in front of our eyes tonight in Nashville, Tennessee, as Kansas City gets ready to face Tennessee on Monday Night Football. Here are tonight's FedEx Aaron Brown stats. Trent Green makes a franchise record 61st consecutive start for the Chiefs, while Billy Volek makes his 5th start of the season for the Titans. On the ground, Derek Blaylock has rushed for 7 touchdowns, while Chris Brown needs just 24 yards to reach 1,000. Now a staple on Monday Night Football, tonight at the Coliseum in Nashville, providing great views of all of the action. And when we come back, the latest on Steve McNair as we get ready for the Titans and the Chiefs on Monday Night Football. Back we come on this clear, cold night to the Coliseum, Nashville, Tennessee. Kansas City ready to face Tennessee. We talked about Steve McNair of the Titans. And for more on Steve, to the field we go. And Michelle Tafoya. Michelle.
Al, Steve McNair will miss his 5th game of the season because of a sternum injury that's been bothering him since week 3. He has played through a number of injuries during his career, but this one is particularly debilitating. In fact, 2 weeks ago, McNair expressed enough concern about his health that he indicated he might consider retiring at the end of the season. Now, I spoke to him moments ago down here on the field. He had no further comment, but he also confirmed for me he is not backing off of that statement. Earlier, I spoke with Jeff Fisher, and I asked him what he thought about his quarterback considering retirement.
One of the things that's happened with Steven over the last 5 years, his offseason has started in May or June because he's always been rehabbing some sort of surgery or something, and he needs an offseason is what he needs. If he carries a major injury into the offseason, then I think things will change. I think he may walk away from this game. If he doesn't, I know he's got a couple, at least maybe 3-4 years left.
Now, Fisher also told us that McNair is bound and determined to play again this season, and he may be healthy enough to go as early as next week. Meanwhile, the Titans are trying to develop a sort of high-tech body armor which would absorb impact and deflect it away from McNair's sternum to protect him in the future, but Al, that might not be perfect. affected until next season.
So a lot of mystery surrounds Steve McNair, present and future. I think a lot of it is frustration to be able to play at the level he does and then not to be healthy. And then the team is 4-8, a lot of things going on, and I think Jeff Fisher summed it up perfectly. He just needs a full offseason.
Right, and the thing is, when you have a sternum, it's a type of thing that you can't move the way you want to, and any place you get hit on your body, it goes right to that area, and it's a very difficult injury to play with. It's one of the few that he's had that he just can't play around.
Lawrence Tynes kicks off for Kansas City. Jason McCadley will receive the kick. McCadley from the 6-yard line. Good run back, something the Titans haven't had many of this season. To the 39, tackled by Gary Stills, and here is the Tennessee offense.
Billy Horton, Fresno State.
Chris Brown, Colorado Buffaloes.
Rob Holcomb, Illinois.
Derek Mason, Michigan State University.
Drew Bennett, UCLA.
Aaron Kinney, Florida.
Chase Matthews, Texas A&M.
Jacob Bell, Miami of Ohio.
Justin Hartwig, Kansas.
Benji Olsen, Washington.
Fred Miller, Baylor.
So Billy Volek out of Fresno State from the 39-yard line. Off the play fake, then throws, and it's caught out in the flat by Aaron Kinney, but that's read perfectly by Shenard Hartz. Gain of 2. Here's the Kansas City D.
Eric Hicks, Maryland.
Ryan Sims, North Carolina.
Lionel Dawson, Detroit Cooley High School.
Jared Allen, Idaho State.
Scott Fujita, University of California.
Kawika Mitchell, South Florida.
Quentin Caver, University of Arkansas.
Eric Warfield, Nebraska.
Booty Powell, West Potomac High School.
Shenard Hartz, El Pueblo.
William Barty, Oklahoma.
So on 2nd and 8 now, it is Volek being chased out of the pocket, throwing on the run, coming back to make the catch is Derek Mason for a first down. William Barty with the coverage, and Derek Mason, one of the more overlooked receivers in the league, 8th year out of Michigan State, but led the league in receptions coming into the weekend.
Yeah, and he's Billy Volek's favorite target. Billy Volek said that they were going to run a lot of keepers tonight, and that's a second play, and it's a second keeper, where you fake to the back going one way, you bootleg or keep coming out the other way, and if you have a guy like Mason, you're going to find him.
Tennessee playing the hurry up here, and Chris Brown takes it to the 41-yard line. Eddie George was the main man for so many years, and then Brown came along as the rookie last year, and they began to work him in. They asked George to accept a restructured contract this year. He didn't, and went to Dallas, and Brown has become the man. He played very well at first, but right now he is what they call turf toe, and that has really impeded him.
Right, and like Jeff Fisher said last night, he can start. The question is, can he finish? How long can he go?
2nd down and 4 from the 41-yard line. Brown's first carry was for 6 yards. A little juggle on the snap, but they get it to Brown, and Brown gets forced out of bounds at the 23-yard line by Willie Pyle. But Brown right now, his first two carries are good for 6 and 18 yards.
You know, Justin Hartwig, the center, makes a good block on this. He's number 77. You'll see him right here. But I tell you, Chris Brown is an interesting runner. You see Hartwig, he gets his guy hooked, and that starts the hole there. But Brown is a straight-up runner, but he has a lot of moves. You know, some of those straight-up runner types run on a straight line all the time. He's a straight-up runner that doesn't run on a straight line.
Now he comes up into the slot, and we've got a whistle before the snap. Tom White is the referee.
Number 71 offense, 5-yard penalty, remains first down.
There was a lot of moving around, and some of it was illegal. That's Fred Miller.
Yeah, you know, they always say that, you know, Chris Brown reminds people of Eric Dickerson, and some of the things that I was talking about Chris Brown having is being a straight-up runner. He's going to take a lot of hits, and he's going to have those injuries. But he has that, you know, below-the-waist movement, a lot like Eric Dickerson.
Chris Brown, now with 1,000 yards, played his college football at Colorado. Number 3 pick last season, 1st and 15 now. Chiefs show blitz. And this is Brown losing the ball. Brown through the middle of the line. That's the one thing Eddie George was noted for not doing. Eddie George would always secure the football. Brown's fifth fumble of the season here. And the Kansas City Chiefs are going to wind up with the ball. And so that drive is thwarted on the fumble. Shenard Hartz whacked him, caused the fumble, and Kansas City will take over 2.5 minutes into the game. Hartz with a hit, and out it comes. By Budweiser, the bright color and crisp, clean taste you'll only find on the King of Beers. Sears, what are you wishing for? You'll find it here. Sears, good life, great price. And Visa, proud sponsor of the NFL. Get ready for the game. Aerial coverage tonight being brought to you by Budweiser. As you look down into the Coliseum, just across the river from downtown Nashville, and Trent Green on first down is going to give it to Johnny Morton. After he fakes the run and gives it to Morton on the end around, and Tennessee, with Keith Bullock leading the way, I think they sniffed that one out.
Well, and one of the things the Kansas City Chiefs wanted to do was a lot of misdirection. This is the misdirection. You start the backs going one way, and then you come back on an end around because they wanted to take advantage of the linebackers. But watch Bullock here. He gets up the field, and he keeps containment. He doesn't go for the misdirection.
And now it's Dante Hall. The Chiefs that time came up and put four receivers in a box on the right side. One on the line, and then three in what would amount to the slot or in the backfield, and Brad Castle is there for the tackle, 3rd and 20.
They call that bunch, but it's usually three. Mm-hmm. When you have four, I don't know what you would call it. Here's what it looks like right here. Three's a bunch, four's a bushel. Bunch.
Whatever it was, it didn't work. 3rd and 20. Green now in the pocket, fires, finds his key man, Gonzalez, but with 20 yards to gain, they get only 17. Donnie Nicky makes the tackle, and Gonzalez makes the catch, but Kansas City will have to kick.
You know, one of the things that Jim Schwartz, the defensive coordinator of the Titans, was saying, the first thing we have to take away is Gonzalez. And you see it right there. They're doing it with a zone. They get Lamont Thompson up there to bump him, and then he finds that hole in the zone. But as you said, not enough for a first down.
17-yard gain. Steve Cheek to punt. Derek Mason to run back the kick. He's averaging only 4.25 yards per punt return. And that'll go down minimally here as he can barely gain a yard. And Mason gets shaken up as well. So their key receiver a little gimpy as he comes back. No score early in the game. Get hurt on the run back, and then he limped across the field, and he will not be in the offensive set on first down here as they work on him.
It looked like he started to relax right here just before he goes out of bounds. Watch right there. He started to relax, and look at that hit on his left leg.
There was Fred Jones rolling into him. Titans already short of receivers, and now Mason is on the bench, and they give it to Brown. Coming off that fumble, and Brown with some good tough running here for a gain of 8, tackled by Eric Warfield. Now Mason's their leading receiver. They also have Drew Bennett, but now Eddie Berlin, who is the number 3 receiver, will have to become number 2. And one guy they're missing, and they've missed most of the season, who's on injured reserve now, is Tyrone Calico, an up-and-coming wide receiver.
Right, so the other thing that they can do is they have Ben Troop, a tight end that they like to split out, and I think that they would use him in a split position.
2nd and 2. And Bullock stops and then throws back to Drew Bennett. And to a chorus of Drews, he's out of bounds at the 50-yard line. Jared Allen that time chasing Bullock. Last week in the first quarter, Drew Bennett caught 3 touchdown passes from Volek against Indianapolis. They scored 24 points in the quarter and none the rest of the game as Indy won the game 51-24. But what a start last week in the RCA Dome. A pass there, the second one coming here, all of them 20 yards or more. Volek to Bennett was the combination. But again, Indianapolis stiffened, didn't allow a point the rest of the day. Colts win going away.
And that's what Billy Volek can do. He can throw the deep ball very well. Right here.
And this time the pass is out of bounds. Eddie Berlin, the intended receiver, not catchable to begin with, covered by William Barty. It'll be 2nd down and 10.
Yeah, and that's when he's the best, when he has that single safety where there's a safety in the middle. Then he knows whether it's zone or man, he gets his wide receivers on the corners, and he just likes to throw it up there. In fact, we're talking to the Titan coaches, and they feel that Volek throws a better deep ball than Steve McNair does. Now, he has a little problem with some of the other things.
Stats would bear that out. Second down and 10. Lionel Dalton comes across the line. Was he induced is the question.
Yeah, we're talking about that keeper where you fake the run and Volek bootlegs out. He's done it three times already.
75. Defense. 5-yard penalty. Remain. Second down.
John talking about the deep balls. The stats. Take a look at that. McNair's rating is just 22.6 on the deep ball. And Volek, 103.4. Now, if you go 10 to 20 yards, it's a completely different story. That's where McNair would have a tremendous edge. But when you throw it deep, at least this year, Volek's done extremely well.
Right, or if you go, who do you want in there? It's a different story, too.
Second down and 5. And there goes Volek deep. And Volek again with a deep pass to Drew Bennett. It'll be first and goal as he beats William Barty. So you put up the numbers, and that rating will go up a couple of more points. 41 yards, first down and goal.
Right, and that's what Billy Volek is looking for. They're coming on a blitz here. And, you know, he was telling me the other day, he said that Drew Bennett, you know, has pretty good separation. He said he has quiet speed. You don't think he's that fast, but all I have to do is get the ball out there. He's a tall receiver, and he'll go get it. You got man on that one? That's exactly what he did.
Started his college career at UCLA as a walk-on quarterback. First and goal now from inside the 5-yard line. Volek hanging in the pocket, throws tip and incomplete at the goal line. It was tipped by Kawika Mitchell, who earlier had recovered the Chris Brown fumble. Second down and goal.
Yeah, we're talking about how Billy Volek throws the deep ball so well, he needs a little more room here. Then you get down, he's inside the 10, and he doesn't have enough room to throw a deep ball, so he becomes rather average. Although he's a good player. I mean, he's a smart player. His dad was a football coach. His dad coached in California at Fresno City College and Sacramento State. He's now the athletic director. So, and, you know, he played at Fresno State in a good program. So he has a good understanding of the game.
Second and goal, and here is Brown. The thing about a kid like Volek, I mean, he backs up McNair. You know you're not going to see a lot of action. This year, of course, is the exception. He had a chance to go elsewhere but chose to remain here. You think the kind of guy who would back up McNair would be a stiff because he never gets the play. Volek is anything but. A lot of teams were interested in signing him.
Yeah, and I think that's every time I watch Billy Volek play, I think that's one of the first things I tell myself is, hey, this guy's not a stiff. I mean, he's not some guy who just carries around a clipboard and then say, oh, no, we have to play the guy. He can play the game and win.
Third down and goal now. Halfway through the first quarter with no score. Fake to Brown. A little floater, and he couldn't get it to Aaron Kinney. Kinney, the tight end, there's a flag down back at the 12-yard line, and the penalty's against Kansas City.
It's going to be roughing the passer. Billy Volek got rid of that ball, and he got hit after he threw the ball.
Dick Vermeil looking at this replay being shown now on the board here.
Roughing the passer. Number 96, defense, half the distance to the goal. That's a first down.
Jimmy Wilkerson.
And Jared Allen was right there to get him too, but didn't. He pulled off and Wilkerson didn't.
I think that was a marginal call.
Yeah, that was a marginal call.
First and goal. From the 2-yard line, Brown. And he's in for the touchdown.
Yeah, we're talking about Chris Brown being a straight-up runner. A straight-up runner usually isn't very good in short yardage and goal line because there's a lot to hit when he comes in here. But he gets in there and he just keeps his feet going. That's the big thing. And you see what he did right there at the end? He got down and went underneath. You see, when he feels a hole there, he did get down. You know, you can be straight up so much of the time, but you better not be straight up all the way.
Well, look at that. Now, as his knee appears to go down, it's too late for a challenge here. Gary Anderson for the point after.
So the touchdown to Brown, they go 71 yards on that march and take the early lead in Nashville. Week we go on record to Miami. Patriots, Dolphins next Monday night. Last week, three onside kicks by Tennessee, but now a more conventional, albeit short kick, taken at the 26-yard line by Chris Horn. And Horn to the 32-yard line. Kansas City will take over there with 7:12 remaining in the opening period. Chris Brown with the touchdown. And Tennessee on top over Kansas City, 7-7. Saturday night on ESPN, Carolina against Atlanta. Falcons clinching the NFC South yesterday. They go to the playoffs. Sunday night, the Ravens and the Colts. And that means Peyton Manning in action with a chance to tie and perhaps eclipse Dan Marino's touchdown mark. Two games this weekend on ESPN Saturday and Sunday. Kansas City now first down, beginning this drive from their 37-yard line. And Trent Green hands the ball off into the backfield. Carlos Hall right on top of Derek Blaylock for a loss of two. Chief offense.
Trent Green, Indiana.
Derek Blaylock, Stephen F. Austin.
Tony Richardson, Auburn University.
Johnny Morton, USC.
Eddie Kennison, LSU.
Tony Gonzalez, University of California.
Willie Roof, Louisiana Tech.
Brian Waters, North Texas.
Casey Wigman, Iowa.
Will Shields, Nebraska.
Jordan Black, Dallas Christian High School.
Jordan Black, who went to Notre Dame, he'll be one of the key guys that Tennessee will try to exploit tonight. And the pass will draw a flag. Eddie Kennison went down to the ground. Andre Dyson on top of him. And in comes the flag for pass interference.
Yeah, you're talking about Jordan Black being the right tackle there. And all the protections that the Kansas City Chiefs have tonight are going to be to help him on the right side.
Pass interference. Number 22, defense. That's a first down.
Andre Dyson just got there a little early. You know, you can bump the guy the first 5 yards. Of course, you can hit him after he catches the ball. But when the ball's in the air, you can't touch him before it gets there.
First and 10, pump fake, then the draw. Derek Blaylock tackled by Bo Schobel, number 95 in midfield, after a gain of one. It'll be second down and 9.
One of the things that Dick Vermeil was telling us last night, that they want to run a lot more draws tonight. And that play there was a draw because the defensive ends of the Titans are kind of small and they're quick pass rusher type guys that stay outside and get up the field, and they want to take advantage of that. They didn't on that play.
They'll run everything, of course, without Priest Holmes, who was on injured reserve, done for the season after a spectacular first half of the year. Green to the outside, and that pass is knocked down. Michael Waddell knocking it down, intended for Johnny Morton. Let's take a look at the Titan defense.
Antoine Odom, Bro Tide.
Kevin Carter, Florida Gators.
Randy Starks, Maryland.
Carlos Hall, Arkansas.
Justin Enna, Brigham Young.
Brad Castle, North Texas.
Keith Bullard, Syracuse.
Andre Dyson, Utah.
Donnie Nicky, The Ohio State University.
Lamont Thompson, Washington State.
Michael Waddell, University of North Carolina.
One familiar name missing, the cornerback Samari Roll out a couple of weeks. He may play before the season is over. Knee injury. It'll be scoped. Third down and 9. Green under pressure. And about 4 Titans are all there, led by Keith Bullock, the key man for the Tennessee defense.
Right, and you look at that defense and you say, who's the best player on it? It's Keith Bullock. That time they bring a safety, too. So you're going to see the blitz, the overload on the right side of the Chief offense. And you see, as you say, Al, about 3 or 4 of them get there at the same time because they brought 7.
Bring 7 guys, and they surround them. There's a flag down here. Cheeks punt. And another flag is thrown as Waddell apparently had called for a fair catch and then didn't make it. So you've got a flag at the line of scrimmage, and then another flag. And, of course, you've got Waddell running back the kick because Mason was shaken up earlier.
I wonder what the heck Waddell was thinking of, because we always had the rule, if you're not going to catch it, then you run away from it. You get away from it because the one thing you don't want to happen is a ball hitting you, because then the kicking team could recover it. Waddell looked like he started to get away from it, and then it bounced, and then he went and got it again.
Two separate fouls here. It was 4th and 16.
See, that when he decided, I don't know if he misjudged it or not, because he called a fair catch, then he let it go over his head, which you can do, but you can't call a fair catch and block. But then the ball bounced, and then he tried to pick it up, and that's when he should have gotten away from it.
Offsetting fouls here. Waddell, a rookie out of North Carolina. Tom White explaining things to Jeff Fisher.
That could be rather lengthy.
Yes, it could be.
Illegal shift. Number 52 on the offense was never set. Illegal use of the hands to the head. Number 28 on the receiving team. The foul's all set. We'll replay 4th down.
It was illegal use of the hands to what?
To the face. On Lamont Thompson.
I think it was a combination of face and head. But it had nothing to do with Waddell. I still think he's a little shaky back there.
Let's see what happens here. It's a windy night, and again, it's one of those stadiums, like almost every stadium in the league, where you have a swirling wind, a little bit of wind shear. And this is a floating kick, not going very far. This time Waddell will try to run it back, and is fortunate he fumbles it out of bounds. So Mason comes out. He can't return kicks, and Waddell calls for the fair catch and doesn't make it. Fumbles out of bounds. Apart from that, no problem for Jeff Fisher. 7-0 Tennessee, and they still have the ball. Luckily. 7-0 in the first quarter, a quarter in which the Titans have 104 yards of offense, and Kansas City is -2. Derek Mason is back in the game on first down, and Brown through the middle up to the 26-yard line, and let's go down to Michelle.
Well, Derek Mason was originally questionable, Al. He has a sprained left ankle, but what they did is they just put the tape right on top of his shoe, right around that ankle. Derek spent a lot of time on the sideline running around, hopping on that foot, trying to put weight on it. He looked really discouraged, but as you can see, he's going to try to go, Al.
Second down and 5, but he didn't run back. Punts. Waddell fumbled out of bounds. Waddell had that job briefly and then fumbled twice. 10 punt returns. Fumbles here tonight, but fumbled it out of bounds. As on second down and 5, Bolick lofts it. It hangs in the air. Ben Troop was the intended receiver. It'll be 3rd down and 5. Willie Pyle with the coverage on the play.
Yeah, we talked about Ben Troop earlier. He's a tight end who they like to split out and use like a wide receiver. And that time they did. He wasn't lined up tight next to the tackle. Ben Troop is out here like a wide receiver. And you see, they think that he's big and strong. He can get by that guy and just throw it over his head. But it was a cover two. They rotated towards him, and he didn't get away from the press corner.
Titans had 13 overall draft choices. Troop, the 40th guy picked overall, Florida Gator. 3rd down and 5 now from the 26-yard line. Out of the gun, Volek. Here comes the blitz. Titans pick it up very nicely. And then to the outside, the pass is caught, but short of the first down. Eddie Berlin came back for it and can't get the first down. 4th and 1.
Well, the Chiefs were in a 3-man line, and then they came on a blitz, and the Titans picked it up well. Billy Volek had plenty of time, but he was trying to throw deep. You see the two guys deep, they weren't open, so he had to come back to his third receiver, Eddie Berlin, and didn't get the first down. That was good defense by the Chiefs.
Craig Hendrick, year after year, one of the best in the league, averaging a tick under 44 yards per punt. And Dante Hall, who had a phenomenal year last year, with 4 returns for touchdowns. Flag thrown. Short kick into the swirling wind.
Let me just say, the first rule is if the ball hits the ground and you're the return, get away from it. Everyone, when the ball is just flopping around like that on the ground, you're in the return, just run off the field. Nothing bad can happen to you. When you stand around there, they can hit the ball into you and come up with it.
Number 36 on the kicking team. Going forward, prior to the snap, that penalty is declined. They'll take the result of the play. First down.
That was Michael Waddell. So the rookie who had the problems with the 2 punt returns is called for that penalty. Of course, the penalty is declined because the kick was so short. And now Waddell will stay in the game and hope he doesn't get torched in the secondary.
And I'll tell you, if I were the Kansas City Chiefs, I'd go after Waddell right now. I'd go after him a lot anyway. But on this play right here.
3:52 to play in the period. Kansas City begins this drive from the 40. The Chiefs with minus yardage. Negative 2 yards in the first quarter. Green swings it to the outside. Caught by Jason Dunn. Tight end flagged down. We've seen a lot of them already tonight. Justin Enna makes the tackle at the 45-yard line.
Al Saunders, the offensive coordinator of the Chiefs, was saying last night that they want to start off the game with the short passing game. And I think that's because of their right tackle. But at some point, they're going to have to
offside.
Loosen things up here.
Number 98, defense, lined up in the neutral zone. It's a 5-yard penalty. Remains first down.
Antoine Odom. There's Al Saunders, who was at San Diego when Kellen Winslow was there as an assistant and briefly took over as the Chargers head coach in 86. Much respected offensive coordinator under Dick Vermeil. First down and 5 now from the 45-yard line. Blaylock. And Blaylock, some good running there. Blaylock, the backup back to Priest Holmes, and we'll also see Larry Johnson. We talked about Trent Green before and some of the numbers he's put up this year. We showed you this 3 weeks ago in the game against New England. If he throws outside the numerals, outside the numbers on the field, there's his rating, 81.4. But when he throws inside the numerals between them, 30 points higher. A lot of that has to do with Tony Gonzalez, the tight end, running free over the middle. But he likes the middle a heck of a lot more than the outside. Of course, 3 weeks ago, John, when we brought that up in the game against New England, what did he do on the next play? Went outside to Kennison for a long game.
Goes outside, and that's the thing. I think when defenses start playing that way, you know.
Encroachment. Number 90, defense. It's a 5-yard penalty.
Randy Starks, rookie out of Maryland.
You know, Jim Schwartz, the defensive coordinator of the Titans, was saying the way we play them is we play them inside out. You know, we play them to, you know, take away the inside and force them to throw or go to the outside. And of course, when you talk to Al Saunders, the offensive coordinator of the Chiefs, he says we're an inside out passing team.
First and 5. That's Dante Hall coming in motion. The fake to him that buys time for Green. And then Trent Green going deep. The coverage is there, and it's almost intercepted. Andre Dyson was in position, and Eddie Kennison becoming a defensive back of sorts as the pass was intended for him to make sure it wasn't picked off.
That was an interesting route there. There was only one pass receiver. Here it is, and he's running it into a zone defense. So you have a defender on the backside and a defender on this side. Andre Dyson is just waiting for him, and he runs that pattern right into the zone and right into Andre Dyson. That's what you get when you have a one-man pattern. You're going to have a whole bunch of guys on coverage.
Second and 5. They split Gonzalez to the right. The pass is thrown underneath to Dunn, and that play is busted up at the line of scrimmage. Justin Enna, the linebacker, is there. Priest Holmes, through 8 games this year, was leading the league in rushing. He had scored 15 touchdowns, 14 rushing, and was on pace to, you know, have another phenomenal year, and then his season ended in Tampa.
He's such a good back. I mean, he does it all as a runner, as a pass blocker, as a pass receiver. You know, we talked about that inside passing. A big part was Tony Gonzalez. Another big part was Priest Holmes.
Third and 5. Green out of the gun to the outside. He goes, and Johnny Morton has it go right through his hands. So they can't convert. The Chiefs will have to punt again.
I'll tell you, Waddell was out there and off, and we gave him a big cushion. But watch, when you say you're going to help your right tackle, here's your right tackle, and watch Tony Richardson. That is what you call a chip. When you have your back come out, take that outside shoulder and chip him, that was a double chip.
Steve Cheek's third punt of the quarter. Goes into the end zone, a yard into the end zone, so it'll come out to the 20-yard line. Minute and a half to play. Billy Volek and the Titans will come out. college resume. David Carr, who was the number one overall pick in the 2002 draft by the then brand new Houston Texans, was the backup to Billy Volek at Fresno State. And Trent Dilfer, winning the Super Bowl with Baltimore in 2000, another Fresno State quarterback.
Look at that. His senior year, he had 30 touchdowns, only 3 interceptions, and was undrafted. What were they looking at? They had to, I mean, it had to be that they didn't think he had enough arm. His arm wasn't strong enough.
Winds up signing with Tennessee, first and 10 as Brown breaks tackles and turns about a 4-yard gain into a 13-yard pickup, finally tackled by Shenard Hartz.
If you're a young running back and you're watching this and you say, what do I have to do? You want a little more bend, I think, than Chris Brown, but you always keep your feet going. You never stop your feet, and you're always trying to go ahead. Keep the feet going, and then you will run through and break out of a lot of things.
Broke out of Bartee's grasp on his way to a first down. Ball to 33. Final minute of the opening period. Rolla under pressure, gets sacked back at the 23-yard line. Eric Hicks and Ryan Sims are both there to drop him.
That's a left side. It was just like an avalanche. It looked like Billy Volek gets back there. He sets, and then he just has to take it. They get back there about the same time that he does. Here's Sims right here. There's Hicks right here. And you see that they just take that right side of the offense. They just get a push, and they just push it right back into Billy Volek. Eric Hicks got inside of Fred Miller, too.
Second down and 18 now from the 24-yard line. Brown on the draw. Good tough running again up to the 35-yard line. So the second quarter will begin with a third down and 7 for the Tennessee Titans, who have 117 total yards to 8 for Kansas City and a 7-0 lead at the end of 1. And Monday Night Football from Nashville resumes after this message and a word from our ABC stations. Tennessee, Al Madden and Michelle Tafoya as we begin the second quarter. Dick Vermeil, the oldest coach in the league at 68. Jeff Fisher has already coached 10 seasons. He took over in a Monday night game in 1994 with a then 1-9 Houston Oilers when Jack Pardee was let go, and he's been their head coach since.
Hasn't looked back.
Third down and 7 from the 35-yard line. Tennessee on top, 7-0. Billy Volek on 3rd and 7 with a deep drop and then stepping up, feeling the pressure. Going to run for the first down. He's going to get it. Slides to a stop at the 49-yard line.
Yeah, I was talking to Billy Volek the other day and asked him what he learned from Steve McNair. And he said that was the first thing, you know, that he said was when to run, when not to run, and when you run, when to slide, and when not to slide. So here he goes here. He sees he's just about to be tackled. He knows that he has a first down, so he knows that he can go feet first and they can't touch him. That was the number one thing he said he learned from Steve McNair.
Needed 7 yards, got 14. McNair listening into the play calls. 1st and 10 at the 49-yard line. Bullock gets rid of it quickly, and that's a 9-yard gain to Drew Bennett, 2nd and 1. Here's Michelle.
You guys were talking about Billy Volek and his very good career at Fresno State. He was so good there that he kept David Carr, a future number one overall draft pick, on the bench for 2 years. So I asked David Carr what it was like playing behind Billy Volek. He said it was frustrating until I went on the practice field and realized this guy could really play. He said he had field presence, leadership. He was an accurate passer, even under pressure. Guys, his dad, John Volek, told me the reason he didn't get drafted, people questioned his arm strength, of all things.
And that coming off that 30 touchdown and 3 interception season. And 2nd and 1, he's going to throw. He's got his man Bennett over the middle. And Bennett inside the 10 and all the way for a Tennessee touchdown. 42 yards.
These fans love Drew Bennett here. You know, Billy Volek was talking about that quiet speed of Drew Bennett. We just saw it there. He's going in motion across the formation. Then he's going to come up. He's going to get done. Then he's going to come back. because of that collision, he's wide open. Now look at him run here. He is getting separation. Talk about free agents. I mean, there's Billy Volek, a free agent thrown to Drew Bennett, and also an undrafted free agent.
Gary Anderson for the point after. The Chiefs have yielded 20 pass plays of 40 or more yards this season. Next highest total in the league is 12. Another one here, and it's 14-0. Back in Nashville, 14-0 Tennessee. Craig Hendrick's kickoff is a beauty, taken at the goal line, and Dante Hall, after backing into the end zone, tries to give the Chiefs some life here, brings it back out to the 30-yard line, tackled by Jordan Kramer, and back we go to the Bennett score.
You know, that we're going to see Bennett right here. He'd come in motion across the formation. Now, all the other pass receivers are going to go to the left side. Bennett is going to come over here to the right side. See, his own guy got picked off. There's William Barty is right here, who's supposed to cover him, and he's so far behind him, the closest guy is the linebacker, Caber. Drew Bennett has 105 yards so far.
And Kansas City has Larry Johnson, last year's number one draft choice from Penn State, in the game for the first time as Gonzalez makes the catch and picks up about six, and here's Michelle.
Well, I'm here with Priest Holmes, who, as you mentioned, a strained right medial collateral ligament, and you're done for the season. How was it making that decision to be done for the season, Priest?
Very difficult decision, because it's one, as a running back and being at that position, that's one thing that you always want to shy away from, not being able to finish the 16 games. So it was definitely a difficult one, but between the coaching staff and the doctors, we decided that it wasn't enough time.
Now, last season, coming off an injury, you actually considered retirement. Has that even entered your mind yet?
No, not at all, because I got about 8 weeks ahead of anybody else in the National Football League because I'm actually on IR. I'm already preparing for next year, and the 05 season is going to be wonderful.
Speaking of next year, what would be the one thing that would help get this team back to the level where the expectations were, back to a 13-3 or at least a prominent team in this league?
Well, the one first thing is cutting out all the mistakes. That was the biggest thing that really hurt us this year as far as our penalties and the injuries. I think we had 5 guys with knee injuries, and it definitely hurt us.
Well, we're sorry to see that your season's over, but best of luck.
Thank you very much.
Back to you, Al.
All right, thank you, Michelle. As Green has a wide, wide open Eddie Kennison, who will walk into the end zone. So blown coverage, obviously, in the secondary when somebody gets that free, and it's a 58-yard touchdown pass to get Kansas City right back into it.
Yeah, we talked about that bunch before, and that's what happened. Kansas City gets in a bunch. You have 3 receivers over here. It's the outside guy. They cover the 2 inside. They just let the outside go, Eddie Kennison. You see, he just runs right by him. They're waiting there to see what's going to happen. You have a post. You have an up. They go with the post. No one stays with Eddie Kennison. That's what that bunch will give you. You put those 3 receivers there, and then the ball snap, and boom, they just all break out of there.
59 seconds after the Bennett touchdown, Tynes with the extra point, and Kansas City makes it a 7-point game. 12:28 remaining in the half. 14-7, Titans. Capital of Nashville.
I was just going to say, it seems like every city we go to has a bridge. Have we been in a city that hasn't had a bridge?
Indianapolis.
You remember?
Well, we talked about the fact Indianapolis is the largest American city not on a navigable waterway. So, I mean, they've got some baby bridges there, but no big-time bridges.
That looked like a big-time bridge here.
It's pretty good.
Good bridge.
A short kickoff. Fielded to the 24-yard line. And this is Troy Fleming, a backup fullback and special teams guy, bringing it back out to the 39, and back we go to the KC score.
Yeah, we talk about the bunch right here. They're playing a cover two, where they're going to bring the corner up here and the safety back, but the post goes here. Lamont Thompson's the safety. He goes with a post, and when Eddie Kennison gets right here, he goes right by the corner, and he's free. You see the safety, Lamont Thompson, Washington. Stay there, back, back, back. Stay in this area, play inside those numbers. He overcommits to this post in here, and there's no one outside on Kennison.
That Tennessee defense is suspect to plays like that. Remember, they're minus Samari Roll. They're minus Andre Wolfo, a couple of starters. Lance Schulters is hurt. Tank Williams is on injured reserve, so they've been decimated in the secondary. First down from the 39-yard line, and the handoff goes to Brown for a gain of two. Browning with the tackle. Last year, KC's defense, that was the problem. Remember, against Indianapolis, they couldn't stop them. So they figured, all right, what are we going to do? They kept all the players. The same guys from last year, all they did was bring in Gunther Cunningham, their former head coach and defensive coordinator, who had been here in Tennessee coaching the linebackers. But it hasn't worked. So they have to go to another plan next year, obviously, through the draft and free agency.
You know, and Dick Vermeil was saying last night that they have to get some speed. They need some secondary help. I think they have to solidify that middle linebacker spot. I think that's a big deficit for them.
Here's Brown. Tackled by Fujita. Their pass defense has been abysmal. I mentioned before, 20 plays of 40 yards. I mean, just put that in comparison to the rest of the league, that the second worst teams allowed 12. 14.8 yards per completion. You have to go back to the Pats in 1990. And look at that. They're giving up, in effect, a first down on every first and 10 pass play.
Well, you know, that could be helped by a dominant pass rusher, too. You know, I mean, you need cover guys, and you need corners, and you need speed and guys that can run, but you also have to be able to put more pressure on the quarterback without blitzing all the time than the Kansas City Chiefs defense can.
Third down and six. Bullock has time, and that enables a man to get open, and that's Drew Bennett to the 37. A flag is down. Flag is down at about the 49-yard line.
They're not saying boo, they're saying Drew.
Drew. Three touchdown receptions in the first quarter last week.
Holding. Number 44. Defense. Penalty is declined. Take the result of the play. First down.
Eric Warfield with the hold.
Yeah, and I think the big thing here is the time that Billy Volek has. You're going to see Eric Warfield is number 44, and he's on him here. And it looks like he's just staying with him, staying with him, staying with him. And right at the end, he just works to the outside and lets him go and doesn't react to the ball in the air. That was the time. That's the thing. You know, a good pass rush could really help this coverage.
This time, Rolex steps up, and that's a nice move made by Brown to pick up the first down. Mitchell finally knocks him down, but not until Brown picks up the first down. And already in this half, 231 yards of offense for the Tennessee Titans.
Yeah, Billy Volek, I was saying, the first thing that he learned from Steve McNair is when to run and when to go down. The second thing was, he said, when you call a deep pass pattern, you don't always have to throw it deep. You can go back to your check down. And that's exactly what he does there to Chris Brown. That you can look deep, and just because it's called a deep pass pattern, that doesn't mean you can't throw a check down.
At the 23 now. Pressure on Bullock. Flushed out and sacked. So Jared Allen, the first guy to start in, great-looking rookie out of Idaho State, who's made a big impact this year, and that's a 15-yard sack.
You know, that's the thing. You know, we were talking about a pass rush, and you need a pass rush, and I think here's where you can start. I think you can start with Jared Allen. He's going to go here. The tackle goes to the outside. He just goes to the inside. The guard doesn't get out. If the tackle goes out, then the guard better step out. When the guard doesn't step out, you're going to have a free rusher to your quarterback.
Second down, 24 at the 37-yard line. Brown on the draw, loses the ball. It's his second fumble. Kawika Mitchell was able to knock it out. Mitchell recovered the earlier Brown fumble.
We talk about the problems with running straight up. I think fumbling is another one because you expose that ball. You expose your upper body, and you expose a lot more of the ball when you run through there.
Everybody but the officials, and now finally they too agree that Kansas City has recovered. And the exasperated Fisher whips off the headset. Gary Stills recovers, and Casey has the ball down by 7. Champion New England Patriots keep on rolling, 12-1 after yesterday's win against Cincinnati. Tom Brady and company next week on Monday night as the Patriots go to Miami to take on the Dolphins. New England and Miami a week from tonight. After the fumble now, Trent Green from the 37-yard line off the play fake. Stepping up, going deep, flag is down, pass is incomplete. Flag down near the line of scrimmage.
They were trying to work Johnny Morton down here on Dyson, Andre Dyson, and Dyson just covered him step for step. Trent Green had nothing to
offside.
Throw to.
Number 28, defense lined up in the neutral zone. The 5-yard penalty remains first down.
Lamont Thompson, you know, one interesting thing, John. Last year, the Chiefs, a lot of takeaways. This year, very few. And this season, in the first 12 games, they recovered only 2 opponents' fumbles, and tonight they already have 2.
Yeah, and I think that's a big difference in their year, too. You know, you brought up earlier that they haven't gotten the kick returns, and the other thing is they haven't gotten the takeaways.
But tonight they recovered 2 of Brown's fumbles, and this is Larry Johnson. We started to talk about him. There was a lot of controversy when you have Priest Holmes as your guy. Kansas City, in the draft last year, picked Larry Johnson out of Penn State. His father, one of the assistant coaches for Joe Paterno. Great college runner, but a lot of people said, we don't need him. And even Dick Vermeil kind of refers to Johnson as the Chiefs' draft choice, not our draft choice.
Well, and they needed defensive help, and they didn't need help from Priest Holmes. Although, at that time, I'll say they didn't know that. Remember, he had the hip injury.
And here is Johnson. As Carl Peterson and the personnel people decided, you know what, we need a little insurance in case Priest Holmes can't make it. We need another runner, and there's a look at what he did. 2,087 rushing yards for Joe Paterno in 2002. And then he was the second running back taken. Only Willis McGahee, picked by Buffalo, went ahead of him. And last week, because Blaylock got hurt at Oakland, he came into the game and rushed for 118 yards. So a good performance last week. Tries to follow it up tonight. He stays in the block here. That enables Green to have time. And then Green has his pass picked off by Michael Waddell. Eddie Kennison, the intended receiver. And so the rookie who's been tonight in trouble on punt returns, a penalty against him earlier, picks up the first interception of his career.
And he was man-to-man on Eddie Kennison. They came on a blitz. Waddell had a man-to-man all the way, and he makes a perfect interception.
Where did you get that feather?
That's the game on ESPN. It's a special Saturday night game, 8:30 Eastern time. And congratulations to Jim Mora and the gang in Atlantis. Spectacular year. Baltimore and Indianapolis, the Sunday night matchup. Good one from the RCA Dome in Indianapolis. Ravens against the Colts on ESPN. First and 10 now from the 9-yard line. And Chris Brown, with 2 fumbles tonight, picks up 6 yards here as we go back to the interception.
Michael Waddell made a nice move on that one. You see he's man-to-man because there's a blitz. Now watch, he goes for the fake there, but didn't stay with it. He just turned and rolled and got underneath Eddie Kennison. You can get beat, you can take a bite, but after you take that bite, you better recover quickly.
Smiling Waddell, he wasn't smiling before, but the big kick there to give Tennessee the ball back with 6:45 remaining in the first half. Is Volek under pressure, look out, and is able to get it off as it's caught by Bennett and somehow avoided that sack. Jared Allen was in his face, had him wrapped up, and Volek able to get it away to Bennett, who's now caught 6 passes for 137 yards.
And I'm surprised that he keeps running that bootleg to the left, because Jared Allen right here is playing it pretty well. He's getting up the field. He's not going for the fake. He's keeping him in containment. I would maybe try the right side on that bootleg, although he's been able to get it off. But Jared Allen gets up the field, makes Volek stop, but Volek still makes the throw.
First and 10 now from the 26-yard line. Clock ticking down 6 minutes, 7-point game. Volek deep in the pocket, good protection, and the pass is incomplete. Crowd looking for a flag, gets none. Barti with the coverage on Bennett.
Hey, you know, he's going to Bennett now because his number one receiver, Derek Mason, we said earlier, hurt his ankle. Remember, we showed that he was back in there, had the tape on the ankle, and he's not in there now. Eddie Berlin is in there for him. So Derek Mason, who would be his normal number one wide receiver, isn't there. So Drew Bennett is his number one receiver.
And Bennett, six catches tonight. And now Jason McGadley comes into the game, number 81, as an extra receiver. Slot to the right, second down and 10. Back to the ground, to Brown, through the middle with that straight-up style, and that's a first down. Finally stopped by Willie Pyle up at the 37-yard line.
You know, when I was talking about that Derek Mason being out, and then Drew Bennett just came out. So he was out on that last play. One thing the Titans are having success doing is running inside. They're running right at these tackles, these inside defensive tackles, and middle linebacker. You say, so where do you need the strength in Kansas City in the defense? To me, it starts right up the middle. The second question you ask right now is, what's wrong with Drew Bennett?
Yeah, Bennett out. Mason, you saw him on the bench. Berlin and McCadley are the wideouts on first and 10. And they give it to Brown. He's up to the 43-yard line, running with that painful turf toe. Of course, what he gets is an injection, but he can barely practice during the week, but they're working him like crazy tonight. He's carried 15 times for 91 yards.
You know, and maybe that's why he's fumbling, too, and not the turf toe, but no practice. I mean, I was out of practice the other day, and he didn't take one play. And here you see, again, when you run straight up, that ball really is exposed out there. I mean, he doesn't get a lot of protection. He doesn't have a lot of bend to protect that ball. And on both of those shots, he took a shot with a helmet right to the football.
Second and 3. Antoine Smith comes in as the backup running back. And Antoine Smith, who earned 2 rings with the Patriots, 2 Super Bowl rings in 3 years at New England, and initially came up with Buffalo, the backup here now, picks up a first down.
Well, whatever was wrong with Drew Bennett, it looks like it's okay now because he just came back on the field. I know Billy Volek feels pretty good about that. Because he's something, you know, you get a guy that's tall like Drew Bennett and kind of has sneaky speed, he can really eat up a cushion quickly.
He's 6'5", 206 pounds, mentioned came to UCLA, walked on as a quarterback. And now Volek throwing off his back foot, and it's caught by Drew Bennett. So Bennett goes out for a couple of plays, and then Drew Bennett hauls in another one. And Bennett tonight, after that 33-yard reception, has 170 receiving yards on 7 catches.
And you're going to see him beat William Barty here. He's man-to-man out here, and he's man-to-man because there's a blitz. They have a free safety. The safety is coming over, but he hits him before the safety can get over there. Watch it. Here comes a blitz. He has a corner. He beats him. He has a little safety help, and Bullock just gets that ball in there.
First down and 10 from the 20-yard line. Bullock again going deep, and it's Bennett who almost comes up with the ball. William Barty is there, and Bennett is looking for a flag, doesn't get one.
And that's the thing that Billy Volek does so well, is just throw that ball up there. And again, he likes Bennett's height because you could throw that either beyond him and let him get beyond Barty, or you can throw it short and let him jump and come back and get it. It was pretty good.
Yeah. Barty saves a touchdown, second down and 10 now, with 3:01 to play in the half.
You feel that Billy Volek feels pretty comfortable right now with Drew Bennett in his first half?
Absolutely. Tennessee will take a timeout here with the play clock ticking down. Right now, Tennessee with 288 yards of total offense. Lamar Hunt, the owner of the Chiefs, on the left. Bud Adams, the owner of the Titans, on the right. I mean, you think back to the beginning of the American Football League, which was founded in 1960. Lamar Hunt founded the league, owned the Dallas franchise, subsequently moved it to Kansas City. Bud Adams owning the Houston franchise, stayed there a long time, and then moving it to Tennessee. 8 teams, and it's amazing. Those two, plus Ralph Wilson of Buffalo, still in the National Football League 44 years later.
You know, and I always think about the old AFL and how grateful a lot of us are that, you know, got their opportunity and are always grateful and thankful, you know, to Lamar Hunt, to Bud Adams, to Ralph Wilson.
Second down and 10. Golek, and down he goes, hung in the pocket, and then John Browning finally able to explode through and sack him.
You know, I look at that picture of Lamar Hunt, and I remember the first year was 1960. And I really think what brought upon the merger eventually was they went up to his dad, H.L. Hunt, and they said, "Hey, your son in this new league lost $1 million. And H.L. Hunt said, "Well, at that rate, he can only go another 150 years. And I thought right then, that brought the NFL to its knees and said, "We are going to have a merger. These guys aren't going away."
They had some guys with deep pockets on 3rd and 22. That pass is incomplete. And then Eddie Berlin gets whacked as he dropped it by Kawika Mitchell. AFL started in 1960. Gene Upshaw, the Raiders, of course, now the NFL PA head honcho, Len Dawson to Otis Taylor, and there's the man who really made it all happen, Lance Allworth, Bambi. Jack Kemp was the original quarterback of the Los Angeles Chargers. Sid Gilman was the original coach of the Chargers, who moved to San Diego the next year. Now Davis, of course, goes all the way back to the beginning. And there is Lamar Hunt tonight in his box here in Nashville.
It was the guy who started it all.
50-yard attempt coming up for Gary Anderson. Kirk Hendrick puts it down. And the oldest player in the league, Mr. Gary Anderson, comes up just short. Right on target, but short. 14-7. Think about the AFL, and this would have been an old Dallas-Houston game in 1960. 8 original teams, and then 2 expansion teams. The Dolphins and the Bengals were AFL expansion teams. But you look at the Raiders and the Broncos, the Pats, Jets, Bills, Chargers, the original with Namath, Dawson, and Blanda, 3 of the 34 Hall of Famers. Super Bowl in the common draft with a merger completed in 70. First Super Bowl was in January of 67. You know, I was thinking today about the AFL. Remember, you thought about if there was a weak link in the league originally, you thought about the Denver Broncos with the vertical socks and all of that. But the Denver Broncos have remained in Denver that entire time. Played close to downtown that entire time as Blaylock makes the catch. And then the Buffalo Bills in that small market at that time. They were going to be a Miami team. Ralph Wilson wanted the team to go to Miami, couldn't make a deal with them, and they've been in Buffalo all that time.
I'll tell you another thing you might know. Ralph Wilson was a part owner of the Oakland Raiders, too.
Oh, I didn't know that. 2-minute
you
warning.
Do now.
Picks up a first down as Brett Cassel is able to make the stop, and it's a first down with a minute and a half to play at the 31-yard line. From the gun, steps away from the sack. Wide open, caught, Johnny Morton in for the touchdown. Keith Bullock put the pressure on, and then Morton makes the catch, and it's a 30-yard touchdown reception to come close to tying the game, which they can do if the extra point is good here.
Yeah, Trent Green made that play by buying a little time there, getting away from Bullock, taking a step. Michael Waddell was the guy that they were working on. He let the coverage go, and Johnny Morton just went right by him.
Now Lawrence Tynes to try to tie the game. And the Kansas City Chiefs down at one point, 14-0, scoring twice. 2 touchdown passes by Trent Green, 1 each to Kennison and Morton. Another look.
Yeah, here's Johnny Morton right here. And you're going to see Trent Green. He's in the shotgun, and he's going to dodge the first rusher. See, Bullock comes from the outside. He comes free. Now, when he dodges him, Johnny Morton just runs right by Michael Waddell. Watch Waddell here. He's looking inside. He's watching Trent Green. You can't do that. Good move by Trent Green on Bullock there to get away, to buy that time to get that ball to Johnny Morton.
There's a name for that. I can't remember what it is. We've seen Johnny do that before.
Yeah, we have seen him do that before. And there is a name for it. If you can't do it yourself, then you don't have to know the name, though.
I think it's the worm. If it's not, arrest me. It's the worm. Now been confirmed. It's been confirmed by crack staff.
No one does a better job in the worm than old Johnny Morton, old J-Mo. USC all those years with the Detroit Lions.
I wonder if Owens could do that. You think Terrell Owens could do the worm?
Well, he wouldn't do the worm unless he could do it better than Johnny Morton.
Right.
And Johnny Morton is one of those martial arts guys. I think that's kind of a martial arts move that Terrell Owens probably couldn't do.
Jason McCadley, now that you said that with a flag down, Owens is probably working on it right now.
Yeah, but knowing Terrell Owens, he wouldn't do it unless he could do it better than
right.
Johnny Morton. And Johnny Morton's been working on it longer.
Holding, number 52, during the return, 10-yard penalty, be a first down for Tennessee.
Morton's copyrighted it. Monday Night Football from Tennessee, brought to you by Southwest Airlines, proud sponsor of the NFL and official airline of Super Bowl 39. Bud Light, fresh, smooth, real, it's all here. Nissan, everything we touch, we shift, and everything we shift, we try to make better. And Snickers, home of the weekly Hungriest Player Award. The worm is turned in this game. 14 all.
I wonder how many people see Johnny Morton do that and want to try doing it right now.
Antoine Smith. You have to be under the age of about 17.
No, I bet a lot of people right now are doing it on their floor. You know, because all it takes is someone to say, I bet you can't do that. And someone else can say, oh, yeah, watch this. Let me see it again. Oh, that's how you, yeah, I can do that. I'll bet you that there are thousands and thousands of people right now doing that on their floor in their living room.
And in bars all over the country. On second down and three, that's caught for a first down by Aaron Kinney. Up to the 35-yard line.
That's a different worm.
Yes. Timeout, Tennessee. Kinney comes limping off. And Tennessee is down to its final timeout.
Well, something, Kansas City really hasn't established anything yet. And, you know, they haven't, like I said earlier, they haven't gotten their running game going. And that's usually what they do because their offensive line is so good. They run the ball, make you get that eighth man, and then go after you. They really had a different plan of attack. And I don't think it's all because of the right tackle, Jordan Black, either. Although last night they were talking about doing things differently because of him.
Well, they've only run 23 plays, and Tennessee's run 39. Green's numbers are fairly ordinary, 8 out of 14 for 131, and really no running game.
Well, that's the thing. I mean, they've only rushed the ball for 21 yards, and that's unlike the Kansas City Chiefs.
First and 10 from the 35-yard line. Taken down to 42, and again they only have one timeout, and they take it. They have to take it right here. 22 ticks to the half, and the game is tied in Nashville.
At work, Fred Parker eats a Snickers.
Steelers 12-1. They'll go to the playoffs, and we'll talk to Ben at halftime. Coming up, second down and three from the 42-yard line. Stumble by Bullock, but he remains upright, then throws deep, caught, and thrust out of bounds is Jason McCadley, who makes his first catch of the night, and in field goal range, they'll spot it at the 22-yard line with 15 seconds.
You feel that Billy Volek looks a lot more like a five-year veteran than he does a backup quarterback. There's a pattern here. You see McCadley, you just get in that zone, you get by that short guy and in front of the deep guy, and as you said, Volek goes back, he kind of stumbles before he gets, then he gathers himself and still makes that throw.
McCadley, former Arizona Cardinal, makes only his second catch of the season, first and 10, after a 36-yard gain, and he's going for six, and it is Bennett for the touchdown.
Are you kidding me?
What a half. Bennett for 100.
even Dick Vermeil had a smile on that one. We said that earlier, and Billy Volek can do that. He has a great touch on the deep ball.
Volek has passed for 274 yards in the half. Gary Anderson for the extra point, and the 45-year-old puts it through. And 356 yards of offense for the Tennessee Titans, 192 for Bennett.
And you watch Drew Bennett, he's the guy right here. Dexter McLean is covering him. And he knows that he has man-on-man. He does an outside escape, goes right up the field, and Billy Volek just throws it right to that back pylon. He says, I don't throw it to the guy. I throw it to where he's going. I don't watch the ball. I just watch him. Dick Vermeil says, huh? Pretty good.
Well, you got the UCLA connection. Dick Vermeil coached at UCLA. In fact, won a Rose Bowl against Woody Hayes in Ohio State in the mid-70s before going to Philadelphia. Bennett, former Bruin, 21-14 Tennessee. Aerial coverage tonight being provided by Budweiser.
Now look at this kickoff coverage here. They have five guys on one side, five guys on the other side, and the kicker, the only guy in the middle.
Little squibber taken at the 28-yard line. Chris Horn, flag is thrown.
I think Drew Bennett went in to get an IV, I bet.
Well, Drew Bennett's on a pace to set a lot of records tonight. One would be most receiving yards in the game.
Holding, number 91, receiving team. During the return, the 10-yard penalty, first down for Kansas City.
First down with 1 second. Flipper Anderson of the Rams had 336 receiving yards in an overtime game against New Orleans a few years back. They are the quarterback numbers. And right now, Bennett with 192. And that's 356 yards of offense for Tennessee. They're on the pace for 712 yards of offense tonight. They get three touchdowns. They lead by seven. It figured to be wide open. We wouldn't lie to you. 21-14, Titans at the half. Coming up next, the Toyota Halftime Show. When we come back after this message from the National Football League and a word from our ABC stations. With John Madden, Michelle Tafoya. That guy's been here before. Hello again, everyone, and welcome to Central Tennessee. What a first half it's been. What a football game this turned out to be. As the Titans kick off and restart the third quarter, a short kick from Hendrick. Dante Hall. And Hall takes it out to the 44, and we check in with Michelle.
Al, I spoke with both coaches at halftime. Dick Vermeil said, hey, we just haven't been in sync offensively, but credit Tennessee, they've taken us out of sync. He said, we can't stop their deep throws, they can't stop ours, but he looks for his offense to be better here in the second half. As for Jeff Fisher, I asked him about his wide receivers. Drew Bennett was severely winded in that first half from getting so many reps. Derek Mason got retaped with that left ankle that he sprained, retaped at halftime. He'll try to go, and they're going to continue to feed Chris Brown the ball in spite of the two fumbles, Al.
Brown, good half. Bennett, phenomenal half. And here's Blaylock as KC just can't get anything going on the ground. And the other thing, too, John, you know, they've been able to stop Tony Gonzalez. He's caught only two tonight for 23 yards.
Yeah, and I think that's why Dick Vermeil is saying his offense hasn't gotten in sync, because they haven't been able to run the ball, and then they haven't gotten it to Tony Gonzalez. And when you think of, you know, the Kansas City Chiefs and their offense, again, you know, it's the offensive line, it's running the ball, it's play-action pass, it's, you know, inside passing, it's throwing to Tony Gonzalez. And those are the things that they haven't done in the first half.
So, disregard that graphic. Meanwhile, we've got an injured Titan, and we're not quite sure who this is. We won't speculate.
You know, Kevin Carter has been a defensive lineman. About half the time they play him as a defensive end, and then when they need a tackle, they move him into tackle, and then they move him in. He's playing tackle tonight, and he's playing very, very stout in that middle. And, of course, the injured guy there is Keith Bullock, who is right now the best defensive player on this Titan team.
Oh, scary moment, but he gets up with a smile on his face, and he is the mainstay. They've lost just about everybody else of significance at one point or another. So Bullock comes out, and it'll be second down and 9 at the 45-yard line. Green out of the shotgun. Blaylock takes the inside handoff, and he has some room, and finally a little bit of oomph on the ground as he gets it to the 38-yard line. Tackle there by Donnie Nicky, by far their longest run of the night here for Derek Blaylock.
I tell you, he gets a good haul here in the left side, and look at the move he puts on Justin Anna, number 52 of the linebackers. Right there. He gives him that little move and runs right by him. When you get to that second level, that's a linebacker level. To get to the third level, you have to put a move on him.
So after that 17-yard gain, which had equaled his total for the entire game until that point, he is stopped in his tracks here on first down.
I think they probably decided, you know, early it looks like they were, you know, trying to do the misdirection thing and the reverse and all that stuff. That got them in a little trouble. They didn't get off to a good start. Looked like the Kansas City Chiefs talked at halftime, okay, let's go back to basics. Let's get solid. Let's run the ball.
Second down and 9. Play fake to the outside goes Green. And that pass intended for Gonzalez is incomplete. And Keith Bullock, who was shaken up, comes right back into the game with the coverage.
Yeah, and that's the kind of athlete that Keith Bullock is. I mean, when you see Tony Gonzalez running down the field and Keith Bullock running with him.
Roughing the passer, number 91, defense, 15 yards, first down.
Travis LeBoy, the rookie from Hawaii.
Yeah, he's the guy that they bring in on passing downs, and he's a pass rusher type of guy, you know, with pretty good moves, and they're not going to let you today hit that quarterback. You can't touch him at all. But look at Keith Bullock run down the field with Tony Gonzalez. Those are two of the real good athletes in the National Football League.
Blaylock to the outside. He goes, and Blaylock gets to about the 15-yard line as Donnie Nicky knocks him out of bounds. Pass chart coming up right now on Trent Green. Talking about his proficiency down the middle for the most part this season, but not tonight.
I think they wanted to go outside, and the Titans wanted to force him to go outside.
Second and 3. Chris Warren in motion. Blaylock is about a yard shy of the first down. It'll be third down and short upcoming. And that's been a problem for Kansas City this season on third and short. Very low conversion rate.
Yeah, and that's where you need that short yardage runner. I mean, it's all about a feel. It's not the biggest guy or the strongest guy. In fact, the biggest, strongest guy is usually your fullback, in this case, Tony Richardson, who is the lead blocker and not the ball carrier. But the ball second back has to have a good feel for it.
Third down, one. Richardson's the fullback. He's going to fake it and then throw it to Gonzalez, and Gonzalez takes the ball to the one-yard line. So they fake the run, good play, and then it's a touch. Gonzalez says he's in, and that is confirmed at least for the moment by the side judge. Now the Chiefs are going to come running out onto the field to try to get the extra point. Kicked as quickly as possible before the replay comes up, and there could be a challenge. Let's take a look at this.
Well, this is Tony Gonzalez's area right here. Anytime they get in the red zone, you know that they're going to get the ball to Tony Gonzalez. That wasn't a touchdown.
Well, not only not a touchdown, but there was a face mask that wasn't called on it. Lamont Thompson with the face mask, and now there's the flag as Jeff Fisher will challenge. So the challenge is, obviously, whether he got into the end zone or not. Even if he wins the challenge, and there's a face mask that was never called and won't be on review. That's not reviewable. I mean, that's not even the garden variety. That's like a 15-yard
Tennessee
face mask.
Is challenging the ruling on the field.
Right, and the official was probably watching the ball to see if it broke
exactly.
The plane, and he missed seeing both things.
Exactly. So Tom White goes to the hood. And we go to a commercial. There. Line judge and side judge come together. Who saw what? Enough for the touchdown.
You know, that's where you want to get in, that left side behind Brian Waters over there and Willie Rofe on that left side. Two tight ends, so you have all your power there. Your power of your guard, your tackle, two tight ends, plus your fullback. Now that is bringing a heavy load to one side. That time, Tony Richardson got the block.
He got to the goal line, then was pulled back. That's the opening drive of the half.
But that is some power over there when you have a Willie Rofe, and then you have two tight ends on that side, and then again a lead blocker. All on this side. You got the two tight ends in here, plus you have that. So that's all that power coming at you here. So you overload a side, and then you lead your fullback on that side. And as I said, that time Tony Richardson got his guy.
Now, far be it from us to suggest that anybody would fake an injury, but Jared Klaus is being worked on. And I'm not saying they're doing it, but I'll let you decide. On a play like that, where they wanted to give enough time to take a look at the replay to perhaps challenge it, because it was close, you know, hey, gamesmanship, who knows?
I don't know. I mean, I don't know that a rookie who's just been active, I don't know how many games Klaus has been active, but I don't know that he would be the guy that would be able to do it.
You know, it's an interesting thing. In this situation, you've got your seventh-round draft choice, a rookie in the game, on what to this point is pretty much the key play of the game. In any event, they've had plenty of time upstairs, have the Titans assistant coaches to look at it, and you could tell that Blaylock had gotten across the line and then was pulled back. So once he breaks the play and he's in for the touchdown, there'll be no challenge there. And Kansas City is an extra point away from tying the game.
Yeah, the Titans had a Christmas party. You know who Santa Claus was?
Jared Klaus.
Santa Claus, yeah. Jeff Fisher said he was a great one. He said he scared me.
Lawrence Tynes for the extra point. Either that or Klaus von Bulow. 21 all. Monday Night Football brought to you by iRobot. Own it on DVD tomorrow. And Norelco, the world's closest rotary shave. Aerial coverage tonight being brought to you by Budweiser. Coliseum here in Nashville. The Oilers left Houston, came over here. 97, actually played their first season in Memphis. And then they played at Vanderbilt Stadium here in Nashville one year as they awaited the opening of this ballpark. Game tied 21 all with 10:26 remaining in the third quarter, and the Titans will handle the ball for the first time in the second half. Tynes with a kick, fielded by Jason McCatley from the 2-yard line. McCatley brings it back out to the 25-yard line. Willie Pyle makes the tackle. touchdown passes in the first half. Billy Volek, 274 through the air and two touchdowns. Chris Brown had those two fumbles, but 91 yards rushing and a touchdown. Bennett had a spectacular first half, 192. Steve McNair again, Bruce Sternum missing another game. Volek making his fifth start. Steve hopes to get back before the end of the regular season. Derek Mason's been in and out, and he's in right now as they start from the 25-yard line. Antoine Smith is the running back, fake to him. And then the pass outside, and that's Shad Meyer, one of their tight ends, making his first grab of the night for a good gain. Out past the 50 to the 46, it's 28 yards to Meyer.
That's the thing, you know, Drew Bennett was so effective in that first half that they get Bennett going deep, and then they bring Shad Meyer out to that same side. And look at the room that he has once he catches that ball, because Drew Bennett just ran that side of the defense off.
Volek has now thrown for 302 yards. Just in effect started the third quarter for Tennessee. And this is Antoine Smith doing some hard running. And he gains 9, the backup to Chris Brown, taking it to the 38-yard line.
And you wonder if Chris Brown is okay. That was one of the things that we talked about earlier, that Chris Brown has a turf toe, doesn't practice all week, is going to play in the game. So we knew he could start the game, but could he finish the game, or how far could he go? And maybe the answer to that was the first half.
Well, he takes a shot, obviously, and you wonder if that begins to wear off, especially after halftime on a cold night, as he did hobble off after his last carry, the 15th in the first half. And there's a false start here against Tennessee.
Right. And it does wear off. And when it's on the top
false
of the
start.
Toe, it's okay.
Number 71, offense, 5-yard penalty, remains second down.
When he has the problem is when the pain goes to the bottom of the toe, and there's nothing they can do about that.
And Michelle will add more to that.
Yeah, you guys, I talked with Chris Brown before the game. He also wears that steel shank in the shoe to keep the toe from bending. But he told me the third quarter is usually when he starts to feel the pain and it swells up. That's generally when he's had his biggest problems with that toe. Third quarter, we'll keep an eye on it.
And that's why Smith is in the game on second down and 7. And Volek throws, and that pass intended for Mason is incomplete. Warfield staying with him step for step.
And you can see Mason limping there earlier. In the first half, we saw they just taped right over his left ankle. Then he went in the locker room, and of course they were able to take the sock off and his shoe off, and they now have the tape job under the left ankle, but it really doesn't look like it's working.
Derek Mason leading the league in receptions coming into this weekend.
He's a guy that kind of has a quiet, great year. You know, you talk about the good wide receivers, the guys that catch all the balls, and you don't always get him on that list, but he sure belongs there.
Third down and 7, and Volek will take a timeout with 8.5 to play in the third period. Tied at 21 in Nashville. Well, there's the horse trailer. And then there's a horse-drawn carriage on a cool night in Music City.
Now, you say you have done that in your life.
Well, I've been married for 38 years. Yep, I've done that.
No, I've never done that.
I got to get Virginia out on the road.
Never found a horse that would be willing to pull me.
But the Clydesdales will be in town pretty soon. Third down and 7. Throws, and there's a flag down, and that's Bennett for the moment making the catch. Tackle by McLean. See about the call.
You know, a lot of things about Billy Volek impressed me, but one is how cool and calm he is. I mean, he didn't start out with, you know, over adrenalized or anything. I mean, he just came out there in the early
illegal
in the game
contest.
He looked cool.
Number 24, defense. Penalty is declined. We'll take the result of the play. First down.
I mean, he just stands back there. They came on a blitz that play. He had two crossing patterns. Watch him just sit back here in the pocket. He has a guy crossing from his left, a guy crossing from his right. He has to find a lane to throw that ball in. He finds a lane and throws it and steps up.
Foul on passing over 200 yards, 205 yards as Smith picks up a couple. Meanwhile, for Billy Volek, playing in place of Steve McNair, 17 out of 24. Volek on the run there. Bennett, of course, has been his main guy on a good night for the Tennessee passing game.
Yeah, we said earlier how well he throws that deep ball, and he's thrown it very well tonight, but he's scrambled, and he's thrown some short ones well tonight. Here's another deep one.
On second and nine, and it is with a flag thrown intended for Derek Mason with Barty right there.
I'll tell you, there's the guy that is getting torched tonight, is William Barty. I mean, I think you have to feel somewhere that they're going after him. It seems like they've been able to run in the middle and go deep on this left side on Barty. And you find one of those things, you stay after him the whole game.
Number 24, defense. That'll be a first down. First and goal.
You see, you think that Derek Mason can't do it because of that left ankle. He got a step or two on Barty. Volek threw that one a little short. If he gets it out in front, that would be a touchdown. If he throws that one like he did to Bennett to the second pylon, that's a touchdown.
1 minute in the huddle. Offense.
Didn't break the huddle. He said they didn't break the huddle. You still can't have 12 men in the huddle.
Well, you heard what Volek said.
Volek said we didn't break the huddle.
But the rule is you can't have 12, even if you haven't broken the huddle, you can't have 12 guys in the huddle because you're trying to deceive the defense.
See, he's counting them all, and they're all huddled up right there, and he sees that they have 12 in the huddle. So he called it then. We used to do that. At one time, that was legal. You'd put 12, 13, 14 guys in the huddle and run three or four off, and the defense didn't know what you were playing.
First and goal, all-out blitz, and that means Bennett is free in the end zone. Touchdown.
When you get the all-out blitz, you're also going to get one-on-one pass coverage. And again, Billy Volek throws this as well as anyone. He just throws it right to that back or second pylon. Just throw it right to that point right there. You see Bennett start in and then come to the outside. He knows the point that the ball is going to, and he puts it right there.
He beats Eric Warfield. Tennessee has the lead again. Anderson converts. Drew Bennett tonight, 212 yards. Drew Bennett is like the reincarnation of Don Hutson. What a performance. 28-21 Tennessee. Drew Bennett thrown to 13 times tonight, 10 catches. That's the most receiving yards in a game by anybody this season. Rod Smith of Denver on Halloween, Javon Walker of Green Bay in late September are the only other guys over 200. The team record, and they carried the records from Houston, it was set back in 1961 as a short kick is fielded on the run by Dante Hall. And he runs it back to the 37. You have to go back to 1961 as the Houston Oilers, and John, you remember, of course, Charlie Hennigan, 272 receiving yards, and that's the team record.
And who threw him?
Your man George.
George Blanda, yeah. Oh, George, if he got something going, he started throwing, he was going to keep throwing. That's the thing with Drew Bennett. I mean, he has that record, and he still has a quarter and a half to go. And the way these Chiefs are covering and the way Billy Volek's throwing, I mean, that thing may keep going and going and going.
We mentioned Flipper Anderson, the all-time NFL record, 336 yards receiving for the L.A. Rams in New Orleans in the early 90s as the pass is caught across the 50 by Johnny Morton, and that's a first down at the Tennessee 46-yard line. 15-yard gain, 7-point lead for Tennessee.
Yeah, and these teams really know each other well. I mean, you think of Guthrie Cunningham, who was the head coach of the Chiefs. Then he came over here to the Titans as a linebacker coach, and now he goes back to the Chiefs as a defensive coordinator. Well, it's kind of all intermingled, and you can just tell that this Titan offense really knows what Gunner is going to do.
Larry Johnson is back in the game as the running back. The Penn Stater gets the ball. Johnson inside the 30, down the sideline he goes, and Larry Johnson goes all the way for a touchdown, 46 yards. Well, I asked you at the beginning tonight, John, would this be a pinball machine type of football game? It is.
And that's what you expect. Again, this is one of those things we're seeing more and more in the NFL where we have very good offenses and not real good defenses. You see here, Larry Johnson gets the ball, takes it inside, bounces the outside, missed tackle right there. Pretty good block down the field, and then he just outruns everyone else. Chris Horn made that block that sprung him, though. And, you know, it's interesting. Chris Horn is a little wide receiver that they put in to block.
Lawrence Tynes for the extra point. So Kansas City has not had the lead tonight, but they keep coming from behind to tie it up, and they do it once again with 6.5 remaining in the third. Tied at 28. Larry Johnson with a touchdown. Of course, he and Vermeil earlier this year made for some interesting copy in the papers when Priest Holmes got hurt and came time for Larry Johnson to begin to assert himself. Larry Johnson with a touchdown run here to tie the game. And now the kickoff is taken at the 2-yard line by Jason McCadley. Out of bounds he goes, tackled by Horn, number 30. So here's what Vermeil had to say after Holmes had gotten hurt in the Tampa Bay game.
It's time, young man. It's time to take your diapers off and go to work, you know. Maybe get an opportunity.
I don't need no motivation. If I need motivation, I talk to my father. I don't need another grown man telling me that I need to take the diapers off. That's not how I get down. That's not how I've been raised.
I think that Dick really meant that, you know, kind of like in a manner of speaking, you know, not as if you're supposed to literally take your diapers off.
Well, I think he meant, okay, it's time to get going now. I mean, you've been behind Priest Holmes, you've been behind Blaylock, but now you have to play.
There's a sack for the moment, but a flag pending as Jared Allen would get the sack. Vermeil subsequently did apologize for using the phrase, time to take the diapers off.
You know, that was one of those things. I don't think that Dick Vermeil was against Larry Johnson.
Number 24, defense. The 5-yard penalty, an automatic first down.
Well, you know, life.
As much as he was the draft pick. I mean, he didn't feel that they had to take a number one a draft pick and take a running back. I mean, he wanted some help in some other areas, and he had Priest Holmes, and he had Blaylock, and he kind of liked them and didn't think he needed another one. They didn't use it.
But tonight he gets an opportunity as he did last week. And you know the way life is. You need time to take the diapers off, and then later in life you put the diapers back on. And with that as a segue to Michelle.
I'm not sure what I think about the segue, Al, but I did talk to Larry Johnson about that issue, about the diapers comment. And he was really hurt. He took it personally, he told me, because he takes football so personally. He said, it's in my bloodline. My dad is a coach. My dad played. My dad was cut from the Redskins. So this is very near and dear to my heart. He said, I felt it tainted my reputation because he felt that Vermeil was calling him a whiner in so many words. And he felt that really tainted his reputation, Al.
Second down and 3, and they pass out here on the flat is Troy Fleming. Wind is blowing. Am I seeing some flurries? Not confetti. Michelle, are those flurries?
They are indeed. They were really, really, really light at the beginning of the game, but just here in the last 60 seconds, they've started to come down, Al.
Yeah, that looks like one of those balls you have, you know, that you turn over and then you turn back and you see all the flurries coming.
Mm-hmm.
And I see Todd Williams is in there at right tackle now. You know, Fred Miller had a bad ankle. They weren't sure how much they were able to get out of him. And Fred Miller's not in the game now for the Titans either.
Right tackle is gone. First and 10. Justin Hartwig is in the game. You know, we thought it was George Blanda, but our man Steve Hurd actually went back and looked. Jackie Lee was the guy who was throwing that day to... Talk about Charlie Hennigan and the team record.
Well, it seemed like so many of those records George did have.
He did. He was only kicking in that game, though.
I'll be good to heck.
Jackie Lee would have called. But, I mean, it's pretty amazing when you think about it. As you go back to those years, as you take a look at Drew Bennett, and what he has done tonight.
You know, he does have deceptive speed. I mean, when you see him, and, you know, you always talk about wide receivers being able to separate. And I think deceptive speed helps you separate. Little moves help you separate. And an accurate quarterback helps you separate. You got flurries flowing over his head.
Justin Hartwig is the player needing the attention here.
And we just said earlier that they've already lost Fred Miller.
And let's check in again with Michelle.
Well, Fred Miller has re-irritated an ankle injury that he came into this game with. He may have to come back onto the field for Hartwig. That looks like the plan. Benji Olsen is in the locker room getting x-rays on his right big toe, so he's questionable. And guys, Chris Brown, who we talked about with the turf toe, he's in the locker room and has been in there since halftime getting treatment. His return is questionable as well. So we thought he might get to the third quarter. Chris Brown hasn't even gotten past halftime, guys.
And it's been that kind of a year. I mean, it's a season in microcosm for the Tennessee Titans. Zach Pillar is also long gone. The guard on injured reserve. And Justin Hartwig, obviously, with a hand injury here as he comes off.
And you know that he is a center.
Todd Williams is in. Eugene Amano now becomes the center. Revamped line, first down and 10 from the 45-yard line for the Titans. Antoine Smith to the 47-yard line.
Yeah, saying that the Titans have a pretty good feel. Mike Heimerdinger, the offensive coordinator for what Gunther Cunningham is going to do. He didn't have a very good feel on that play because they came on a blitz, and the Titans ran right into the Kansas City blitz. The guy who does a good job with this offense, Mike Heimerdinger, you know, he's one of the offensive coordinators that stays down in the field where he can talk to the players and see the players, and no matter who plays, he doesn't make very many adjustments.
Ball up under pressure, gets it off to Shad Meyer. Across the 50-yard line to the 48-yard line, Willie Pyle coming on the safety blitz. That time got to him, but Volek does a real good job with guys in his face.
I know, because there's every time he's run a bootleg tonight, there's been a guy in his face, and he's been able to get rid of it. And the guy that's always open is a short guy. Every time that he's run a bootleg, the Chiefs have it contained, but they haven't covered the short guy.
So third down and 3.5 to go, third quarter. Game tied at 1 point, Tennessee, led by 14. First guy to get a hold of him, and then Fujita is there to finish him off.
And that's the first time the Chiefs stopped that. We talked about the keeper of the bootleg. Every time he was doing it and throwing it to the short guy, that time he runs the bootleg. He's going to come out here to the right. He's going to throw it to the short guy. The Chiefs are going to come up right here and make the play before he can get the first down. Good fourth tackle by Eric Warfield.
They line up. Are they going to fake this? They line up as if to punt. Then you've got Craig Hendrick, and they snap the ball diagonally to Fleming. And you can feel it coming. The Tennessee Titans, they love to run a lot of fake plays, trick plays at 4-8. Why not? Jeff Fisher, 3 onside kicks last week, and you can smell that one.
Jeff Fisher told us last night that he had 4 fake punts. Now watch this. This takes a special snap. I don't know that I have ever seen this before where the ball is going to come out from here out this way. You know, usually it goes straight back. That is a heck of a snap to be able to have the ball there and snap it out sideways.
You know what he did? He didn't snap it between his legs. It's just like a lateral pass.
That's how he did it.
From the 33-yard line, Volek throwing into double coverage, and two Chiefs are there and run into each other, Hartz and Warfield. But the snap on the pass intended for Bennett was just a diagonal left-handed snap.
I think it does go between his legs, though, doesn't it? Oh, no, it doesn't. He just takes it up left-handed and just throws it out there. And then they have four blockers out there, and he just runs right behind them.
That's Ken Amato with the snap.
Well, you know, last week what Ken Amato did, he was a center, and in a fake punt, it was a center eligible. They threw a pass to him.
Didn't work.
No. No, they covered that one. How they knew that was coming, I have no idea. But that time, I mean, that snap was something, because you wouldn't expect that you would be able to snap it out there. You know, usually you would snap it right back and then, you know, flip it out there to that guy.
That is it's a legal snap. Warfield is the injured guy. As long as it goes to a back, and it did, Amato snap, a legal snap.
Eric Warfield is the underneath guy, number 44. He runs right into his safety, Hartz. Shenard Hartz. One of the times they finally had Bennett covered on that one.
It'll be second down and 10 in a week from tonight. We go to Miami, where the New England Patriots take their glossy 12-1 record to South Florida to take on the Dolphins. That's Monday Night Football, New England at Miami next week.
That's going to be interesting now. The New England Patriots with Charlie Weiss, their offensive coordinator, taking the head coach at Notre Dame. That's a tough situation to be in, either being the Patriots or being Charlie Weiss.
Congratulations to Charlie on getting the job in South Bend. He's on second and 10, Antoine Smith. Taken down before he reaches the line of scrimmage. And then some extra action. John Browning is there, making sure he finishes the play.
You know, early in the first half, that's where the Titans were having a lot of success. They were really gashing the Chiefs on that inside run. They went to the well that time and it wasn't there.
Browning trying to take a swing at him.
Well, it was Antoine Smith, I think, tried to knee Browning first. That was a retaliation.
Getting that fake knee. Third down and 10 from the 33-yard line. Bolette. And that is almost and should have been intercepted by Warfield. The pass hanging, Eddie Berlin was the intended receiver. And that'll make it fourth down.
They're not giving them that one anymore. They're giving their corners over-the-top help. You see, you have a corner here, then you're going to have a safety over the top. You see, when he gets by here, you're going to have the safety coming in right here. So you're going to have to throw it between that corner, and because he has the safety over the top, he can play that underneath.
So it's fourth down. Earlier, Gary Anderson missed a 50-yard field goal attempt. Craig Hendrick can also kick field goals. He's the punter. And, of course, Joe Nedney was their guy. And Nedney with a tremendous leg, but he was hurt at the beginning of the season, which forced them to pick up Gary Anderson.
I'm sure what Jeff Fisher is thinking about now is some kind of fake, and the Chiefs are also thinking about it.
ESPN, two games this weekend, Saturday night at 8:30, Carolina against the Atlanta Falcons, the new NFC South champs, and then the Baltimore Ravens, and Peyton Manning and the Indianapolis Colts have at it on Sunday night on ESPN at 8:30 Eastern Time. Hendrick is in the game. He can punt, he can kick long field goals. He can also throw. Hendrick has thrown 13 passes in his NFL career.
In fact, we were asking Jeff Fisher last night who would be his backup quarterback or third quarterback, and it could be him.
Well, they huddled, and then they raced to the line, and Hendrick, for the moment, punts it away, but timeout had been called by Kansas City.
If not, Kansas City had about 20 guys on the field.
And the Titans raced to the line. I had no idea what they had in mind at that point, except to force Kansas City either into a penalty or to take a timeout, which they did.
Well, Kansas City wasn't sure whether they should be playing a defense or be playing a punt return. And I think in this case, I would just play a prevent-type defense.
AFC, the dominant conference this year, playoff picture at the moment. Pittsburgh and New England would be seeded 1-2, and Pittsburgh would be the one seed by virtue of their win over New England. San Diego and Indianapolis in the 3-4 spots would host wild card games. And the Jets and Baltimore are next, though Denver is right there at 8-5 as well.
Well, Jeff Fisher said he had 4 fake punts for tonight's game. He's used 1.
And Hendrick with a flag down. Bell with some backspin on it. Down to the 19-yard line, but another penalty. We've had 14 accepted penalties in this game, 9 against Tennessee.
You know, Jeff Fisher, being an old defensive coach,
there's
always
no
a little paranoid.
Play. The player who is moving was not on the line of scrimmage and was moving backwards. Therefore, it is legal. Tennessee is down the ball downfield. It'll be first down for Kansas City.
I was just going to say that Jeff Fisher thinks that they watch him. If he talks to a special teams coach, Alan Lowry, then he's telling him to run a fake play. So he said, all night I'm going to have to go talk to Alan Lowry so they won't know when I do talk to him that I'm calling a trick play.
The old ruse.
That's an old defensive coach. That's the way defensive coaches think.
That was a 14-yard punt. So it's first and 10 now from the 19-yard line in the final minute of the period. Johnson to the outside, taken out of bounds at the 20-yard line. Keith Bullock running him out of bounds at that spot. Through the years, Dick Vermeil has had the same kind of back. When you take a look at size and weight and all that with Wilbert Montgomery in Philadelphia, then he goes to St. Louis, and there's Marshall Faulk. And then here with Priest Holmes. So Larry Johnson, not the type of back normally in the employ of a Dick Vermeil coach team. Second down and 8. And this is juggled and not caught. So no fumble. Eddie Kennison never had control of it. It'll be third down and 8.
But the other thing is when you have a healthy Priest Holmes, you don't need anyone else. I mean, because he could do it all. I mean, he was an every down back, and you know, he was a tough guy, and there was just no place to play. So someone would say, why don't you play Larry Jones? Well, I mean, I don't play Larry Johnson because I have Priest Holmes, who's one of the best running backs in the NFL.
Third down and 8 now from the 20-yard line. Avoids the sack, out of the pocket, throws, and the pass is ruled incomplete. Ryan Long was sacking him as he gets the pass away. So it'll be third and long when we come back. That's the end of the third quarter, 28-28 between the Chiefs and the Titans, and Monday Night Football resumes after this message from our ABC stations.
He just loves football.
Al Michaels, John Madden, Michelle Tafoya start the fourth quarter with a Kansas City punt. As Steve Cheek will punt, Michael Waddell, the rookie, is back to receive it for Tennessee. The game tied 28-28 between 2-4-8 teams as this 14th week of the season concludes. Good kick. Waddell fair catches this one at the 35-yard line. Billy Volek, not drafted, and he talked about it.
They can't really measure your heart, you know, your dedication to the game, the love of the game. You know, Joe Montana didn't have, you know, he wasn't tall like Peyton Manning. He didn't have a rocket arm like Favre. But all he did was win championships. And I think because he loved the game and he had a huge heart, you know, that's what determines how good a quarterback is going to be. You know, what is inside is what is most important.
Billy Volek tonight, 332 yards and 3 touchdowns. Swinging to the outside is Antoine Smith. You know, John, we've been talking about McNair, and Michelle touched on it at the beginning about, you know, musing about retirement and all that, and Jeff Fisher saying he needs in offseason. Let's say McNair did retire. Is Volek good enough to be the guy?
Yeah, I think he would be good enough to be the guy now, and then you'd go after another one. You'd go after a young one to develop behind him. But I mean, the way he plays, I mean, he's not maybe in the top 25% of the quarterbacks in the NFL, but you know, he's in the 50%.
Seen more action obviously this year than at any time in the past, because McNair has been until now indestructible. Play clock runs down to a nub, and Robert Holcomb gets a rare carry to the 40-yard line. McNair and Volek, their numbers quite similar this year coming into tonight, and Volek has spread it out a little bit tonight with a pass rating that's considerably better than McNair. McNair last year led the league in pass rating.
Yeah, he was the co-MVP. He and Peyton Manning were the co-MVPs of the league, and that was one of the things, you know, you'd mentioned earlier. You know, you say what happened to the Titans this year, and part of it was not having a healthy, great quarterback.
Third and five, he gets jostled in the pocket, but still gets it away, and Mason's forward progress will net him a first down up at the 46-yard line.
Yeah, I was talking about Billy Volek and how he stands back there in the pocket, and he just stood back there that time, and he took a blow. I mean, watch him. This is what he sees. Now he moves a little to his left, because you have to find a lane to get that ball in, and in moving to the left to find that lane to throw it in, he's going to take a pretty good shot right there.
Lionel Dalton devoured him as he got rid of it. First down at the 46-yard line, 12:45. Remaining in regulation.
The part that bothers you after they devour you is when they fall on you.
They consume you. Holcomb stopped after one. Here's Michelle.
Well, we heard from Billy Volek just a second ago. He's a pretty quiet, unassuming guy, albeit with a big heart. His dad, John, told me that teammates of Billy's, past and present, say he can electrify a huddle. And John Volek told me that when Billy crosses those chalk lines on game day, he is in his arena. He said, you know, he's a nice, quiet guy with no ego. I love to golf with my son because I get to see him as a competitor, but he's also a guy I could sit with in a fishing boat for 8 hours at a time, Al.
Beautiful description. Second down and 10. And that one is incomplete, overthrowing Mason, and Dexter McLean got his hands on it. Third.
You know what I wonder about his dad, why his dad couldn't recruit him. That had to be the tough thing. His dad was a head coach at Fresno City College, got the job at Sacramento State as a head football coach when Billy Volek was coming out of high school. His dad wanted him to go to Sacramento State with him. Billy Volek went to Fresno State. Now, that is tough.
Well, no, I always thought it was so tough for a guy to play for his father, especially a quarterback. And, well, you know, we're musing about the answer, but Michelle has it. We'll get to it in a second.
I remember when John McKay recruited his son. He wasn't a quarterback then.
Receiver, J.K.
J.K.
Drew Bennett stopped at the 48-yard line. Michelle, the answer is?
Well, the answer is that Billy wanted to go his own way, and John was willing to let him do that. You know, Billy's older brother, Joe, was a junior college All-American for John, and Billy thought, well, gosh, I see what my older brother went through playing for my dad. I kind of want to go my own way. But it was really, really tough on John Volek. He said he was just torn with that decision, but he had to let Billy make it for himself.
No, that's true. As a dad, I mean, you do, but it is a situation. I mean, a kid getting out of high school, and, you know, do you go with your dad or do you go someplace else? It had to be tougher on Billy Volek than his dad.
Craig Hendrick punts. And it takes a quick skip into the end zone. He had put it down at about the 8-yard line, but then it went flying into the end zone for a touchback. 11:09 left, tied at 28. Slipping into, I think, the 20s right now. Started at 37. fourth catch of the night. And a flag at the end of the play. Some extra stuff at the end. Justin Enna involved in the action.
I'm sure that someplace Al Saunders is thinking, we got to get Tony Gonzalez back in the game. You know, we're starting the fourth quarter here. We're tied. We got to get him.
Personal foul. Grabbing the face mask. Number 55. Defense. It's a 15-yard penalty. An automatic first down.
Brad Castle with the automatic first down now, and that moves them all the way out to 38, to the 38-yard line. Chiefs this season averaging 418.8 yards per game. Their one-loss record, 4-8. And look at that. 20 teams in the history of the league have averaged 400 yards a game. None finished with a losing record. And the Chiefs, not only with a losing record, but even if they won all of their games, they'd only get to 500. Derek Blaylock up to the 41-yard line.
None of them have had to play with this defense. And this defense just gives up way too many big plays. I mean, that's the thing. I mean, you're going to miss tackles. You're going to get run on sometimes. But to have those big plays, I mean, to have guys do to you what Drew Bennett is doing to this defense tonight, you're not going to have a winning record.
463 yards already yielded by the Chiefs from the 41. Blaylock. So the question about Dick Vermeil now, he signed through next year. He and Carl Peterson go back a long way, Carl the president and GM. Chiefs have always been a very steady organization with Lamar Hunt and Carl really wanted Vermeil to come back. And Dick indicating that he will come back. But, John, I begin to muse, if they don't finish particularly well, you wonder if he will next year.
Yeah, I think he will. Now, I mean, not finishing particularly well. I mean, I don't know what would happen in the next three games. I mean, if disaster comes up. But, I mean, they're playing well enough, and I feel that he's strong enough right now that he wants to come back.
And that pass is incomplete. Tip intended for Jason Dunn.
Like I said, we talked to both coaches. I kind of felt, 4-8, they'd both really be downtrodden, but they were both pretty peppy, I thought. And I think that the disappointment that they've had of this season has probably come and gone.
I think you're right. Because when we had Dick 3 weeks ago against New England, he looked a little downtrodden. You could see the season slipping away. And that punt will bound out of bounds at about the 23. So Fisher's Titans will take the ball at that spot with 9:20 left in a tie game. Tonight on Nightline, the jurors who convicted Scott Peterson of murder and sentenced him to death this afternoon speak out on what really happened in the jury room. Full coverage of the day's dramatic conclusion. First interview with the jury's foreman on Nightline following your late local news. Antoine Smith to the 21-yard line. It'll be second down and 9.
Yeah, I see the Chiefs have Dexter McLean, number 22, in their right corner. They finally got William Barti out of there.
No more truth. Nothing truer. I can't even speak. I'm so cold right now.
How cold do you think it is?
Well, they're telling us 34, but
no,
I
no
know
way.
34, yeah. And this is no 34. This is 27.
Or between 3 and 4.
Between 3 and 4? Second and 13. Volek. Up to the 30-yard line, and he's short of the first down by about 3.
One of the things about this game, you see Derek Mason in there, playing with the bad ankle, and offensive linemen, playing with bad legs, coming in, going out, and people say, the season's over, these guys aren't, they're not in the playoffs. What do they have to play for? They play because they're pros, and there's a game to play, or they're football players. They don't even have to be pros. There's no other way to play it, and I think that when you see a game like this and players going through it, you've got a lot more respect for them.
On third down and 3, Volek under pressure, and Bennett reaches for it but can't make the catch. Kavika Mitchell put the pressure on that time. Warfield with the coverage.
It starts off with a blitz, so Billy Volek knows that he has man-to-man out here, and he's had so much success. And we see the quickness that Bennett has, and then the separation. You see, he got a couple of steps on Warfield there, and he just needed about another half inch.
Craig Hendrick.
Dante Hall's been quiet tonight, hasn't he?
Quiet, yep, after that very noisy season. This is a line drive kick, and Hall's going to have a chance to run it back. But the coverage is terrific. Knocked down immediately by Scott McCarahan. So McCarahan, one-time Packer and Dolphin, with the tackle. Here's the Kansas City huddle. Chiefs trying to break out of it. Icy night.
Well, how cold does it have to be for that stuff to stay like that?
A lot colder than the 34 they told us it just was.
We aren't going to buy 34.
No way. First and 10, Kansas City at the 19-yard line. Fred Green over the middle. There's Gonzalez, and Gonzalez fights his way up to the 46-yard line.
Yeah, the big part of this Kansas City offense is Tony Gonzalez, and you felt that he really wasn't involved in it. On the last series, they kind of got him the ball, and now they come and he makes a double move on that. You see what he did to Lamont Thompson? He makes an out move and then goes up. So as he was in the middle of the field, he gave him a little out move. Lamont Thompson goes for that out move. Then he goes up, and Trent Green hits him.
6'4", 248, putting on that kind of a move for a 27-yard gain. And now the ball given to Larry Johnson, who moves it up to the 48-yard line. Green might have hit his hand on a helmet as he releases that, gets the pass away to Gonzalez. Well,
we're talking about how cold it is there, and he does. I mean, he just steps right into that one.
Bo Schobel, number 95. Tries to get some feeling back into that hand. It's second down and 8 now from the 48-yard line. Good protection. To the outside he goes. Gonzalez again, but only a 2-yard gain as Bullock wrestles him out at midfield.
Yeah, don't you feel that they just felt that, there's time to get Tony Gonzalez in this game? It's usually the running game, as we said earlier, and Tony Gonzalez. They haven't been able to get the running game really going with any consistency. And until now, they really hadn't gotten Tony Gonzalez involved.
He's now caught 6 passes. No other Chief has caught more than 2. Third and 5. Green will take the snap out of the gun. Gonzalez again, so a steady diet of passes to Gonzalez. Lamont Thompson is there again for the tackle and first down.
Yeah, he was in the slot that time, and it was like he was a hot receiver. I mean, he's just going to come here, and you see the blitz. Now, once he has the guy on him and he blitzes and he sees him go, he's just going to take the area that they vacated. And Trent Green saw it, and that was enough for a first down.
Passes Kellen Winslow on the all-time list now with 542 receptions among tight ends, and that pass is incomplete, and again going right back to him.
He's working Gonzalez now, and Trent Green was telling us last night that with Tony Gonzalez, he said Tony likes the ball high, and he likes to throw him the ball high. That time he did, and it went right through his hands.
There's the list for tight end. Shannon Sharp at 8:15. Ozzie Newsome had held the record for a lot of years. And now Tony, number 3.
Al Saunders is the offensive coordinator of the Chiefs. Coached the San Diego Chargers when Kellen Winslow was there. And he said they're doing a lot of the same things here with Gonzalez.
Inside handoff. Larry Johnson inside the 20, the 10. And Larry Johnson for the touchdown. So they spread it out. They give it to Johnson on an inside give. And Johnson scores his second touchdown of the night on a 41-yard romp.
You know, sometimes we have that old thing that you're going to run the ball, you know, to throw, establish, run, then throw it. Sometimes you can establish the pass. Watch Willie Rofe here. You can establish the pass and then go for the run. When that end gets that wide, he doesn't even have to block him. So he can go up to that next level. Rofe sees that the end was wide. He just steps up. He gets that linebacker, and Johnson is right behind him.
And for the first time tonight, Kansas City has the lead, 35-28. So they have now led in every one of their 13 games this season. Took them a while, but they get there. Up by 7 with 4:49 to go in Nashville. To Miami we go next week as the New England Patriots, with Tom Brady and company, the world champions, heading to Florida. AFC East rivalry, Patriots against the Dolphins. It's amazing what 100 proof will do, huh?
Doing that without a helmet.
And a few other things.
That's his problem. That guy played for years without a helmet.
Jason McCadley at the 19-yard line. Up to the 33, and here's the tie-breaking touchdown.
You see what they did? They get in the shotgun here, and they're going to run the draw here to Larry Johnson. They let Antoine Odom go up the field. Now, he has to make the play because Willie Rofe comes out, and then he gets up here on Bullock. Now, when they let him go free, he has to make that play. But they widen him out because they're in a shotgun, make him play. See, right there, he has to make the play. When he doesn't, Willie Rofe just engulfs Bullock, and that's the thing that's going to free Larry Johnson,
who has now rushed for 104 yards tonight, those two long runs, the bulk of that yardage. And now Billy Vola goes to work and goes over the middle and too high, intended for Troy Fleming, the fullback. Second down and 10, some big numbers being put up tonight. Over 800 yards of total offense in the game, 344 through the air. Three TDs for Volek. Bennett, of course, had that phenomenal first half, and he has scored three touchdowns. And then Larry Johnson has come on here in the second half with those two touchdown runs to vault Kansas City into the lead.
You see Dick Vermeil hugging Larry Johnson?
All of a sudden, fast friends again.
Touchdown runs are a great deal.
Mm-hmm. Second down and 10, and that's caught by Bennett, reaching out, and Bennett has a first down at the Tennessee 49-yard line. He's out of bounds.
Yeah, you'd think at some point the Kansas City Chief defense would come up and press Bennett a little. I mean, you just can't give him that big a cushion and then let him run in front of you or give you a double move and run by you. I mean, you have to take something away. The Chiefs have just really, you know, and again, it's easy to say they've let Drew Bennett, you know, have their way with him. I'm sure they're trying, but Drew Bennett has had his way with him.
12 catches for him. Team record is 13 by three different Oilers/Titans, the last of which was Hayward Jeffries. And Volek goes down. Lionel Dalton gets in there. Secondary does its work, and then Dalton cleans up with a sack.
He got the sack because Billy Volek had to hold that ball too long. He had Bennett going down the middle, and then he had Derek Mason on the outside, and he goes play action pass, and he has two deep guys, and they were covered, and he had to wait too long, and then Lionel Dalton got there. See, Bennett is just too tired to run fast now, I think. He's being covered by a middle linebacker.
Second down and 17, ticking down to 4 minutes. And Bullock wide open over the middle, and he guns it to Ben Troop, who's a little short of the first down. They'll spot it at the 42-yard line.
Hey, and he's a big target, and they use him a lot like the Chiefs use Tony Gonzalez. And, you know, he's not the blocking type of tight end. He's a tight end that you can put in a slot, you can put out wide. He's a good middle receiver. He's a good deep receiver.
Close enough to measure.
In fact, when the Titans get down in wide receivers, they really use him as a wide receiver.
So third and one coming up, and as we look toward the climax of this one, Tennessee has one timeout, Kansas City has two.
different receivers tonight for the Tennessee Titans. 10 have caught passes. Bennett's caught 12. Nobody else more than two.
Drew Bennett just came off the field again, and I think he's just running out of gas. I mean, I don't know that the wide receivers used to run in a game as much as Drew Bennett has run tonight, because, I mean, he's not getting a lot of those short things. I mean, everything that he runs is long and down the field, like junk.
233 receiving yards for Drew Bennett. Third down, short one. Bolek rolling, throws, flag is thrown. He gets the pass intended for Robert Holcomb, and he was interfered with by Fred Jones, the linebacker.
Yeah, and that's that same thing that they've been doing all night, that bootleg or keeper. You're running off with a deep guy and throwing the ball to the short guy. They started off, in fact, the first two plays of the game for the Titans were that play, and they've been running it the whole game.
We have two fouls on the play. One for pass interference, which we are picking up because it happened at the line of scrimmage. By rule, you cannot have it. We have defensive holding on number 98. It's a 5-yard penalty, an automatic first down.
Eric Hicks. Here's the first call. On the line of scrimmage, they picked that one up. And the holding on Hicks, and that's an automatic first down. At the 37-yard line. And then Volek goes down. Monty Beisel, the outside linebacker, comes in for a big sack. And another flag is down.
That was a heck of a play by Monty Beisel, because he just kept working. He was down on the ground, and it looked like he came from underneath someone to get Billy Volek. Beisel was a middle linebacker. Remember, he got hurt, then they moved him back to weak side linebacker.
This penalty is against Tennessee, which would be declined by Kansas City.
Holding, number 32. Offense. Penalty is declined. We'll take the result of the play. Second down.
I said that Monty Beisel came under someone, and that was who he came under. It was Antoine Smith. Watch Antoine Smith. He's going to come to this way. Monty Beisel comes and just goes right underneath him. Well, he's grabbing his right arm there, I guess is what they call holding. But Beisel did a smart thing. I mean, he just got down low and just went right underneath him.
Fifth sack of Ola tonight by five different guys. The pressure is on again, but they set up the screen. And that's Antoine Smith, who's inside the 20, inside the 15. And when you blitz that many guys, the downside is you get the pass away, and it's off to the races for Antoine Smith, 31 yards.
And especially a screen pass, and that's exactly what you do. The old thing, when you get pressure from one side, you also go back to that side with a screen pass. The screen pass is going to be back to the left side. They let the blitzers come, they invite them, and then Antoine Smith has a clear shot. Good blocking downfield. Tell you, that is the perfect play call for that defense.
31-yard gain on second and long. First down at the 13. Smith limped off after the play, and then the pass to the end zone is broken up. Eric Warfield breaks it up, intended for Drew Bennett.
I think Eric Warfield by now knows that when they get down into this part of the field, just run to that second pylon, because that's where he's throwing it. He's going to throw it to Bennett, and he's going to throw it right up to that second pylon.
Second and 10 at the 12-yard line.
Bennett was inside him. You see what Warfield's doing now is he's keeping that. Last time he was beaten, he took an inside, let Bennett get outside him. That time, he did not let Drew Bennett get outside of him.
Bennett comes wide to the right. Second down and 10 from the 13-yard line. Bola throws underneath. That is caught by Meyer, and he is rolled down by Scott Fujita. John, remember the name, one of the great names in football, Cloyce Box.
Cloyce Box, yes, I do. Wide receiver, wasn't he?
Detroit, in fact. He holds the record most touchdowns over a two-game span, 7. Bennett touchdown receptions. Bennett has six in the two games and a chance, of course, to tie that here. Third down and two, 2.5 to go. Bennett wide left this time.
After this game, Bennett's not going to get out of bed till Wednesday.
On third and two, the blitz is on, and Tanner Mason, who stops and makes the catch for the touchdown. So they sent Bennett to the other side, put Mason on the near side, and he just stops and makes the grab.
You know, and Billy Volek has been throwing that one all day to that second pylon, making him go there. That one, he just underthrows it, or what they do is they'll throw it to the back shoulder. Because Warfield started playing it, he started playing that pylon, he started playing over the top. When they do that, you throw it in behind him on the back shoulder.
And Volek took a shot and he comes off.
Volek's taking a couple of shots tonight.
A lot of blitzing, especially in the second half. Gary Anderson to try to tie the game. Nice move by Hendrick, the snap a little high to get it down. And booted through with 2:26 remaining in regulation. Figured to be a shootout. We got what we asked for. 35 all. 70 points in the game, and we're tied with 2:26 remaining. The Tennessee Titans, will they try an onside kick? Well, Hendrick will kick it off. They have five guys to the right, five guys to the left. Six guys up for Kansas City, and it's a conventional deep kick, which Hall backs up from the three. Hall out to the 23-yard line.
Let's watch Derek Mason here. Here he is out here on Warfield. Now, again, you can try and get by that guy and just throw that fade. Now, if you don't get by him, you stay underneath him. You stay here. The ball is thrown at that back shoulder or short, and you let him stay over the top, and then you take it underneath him. But I'll tell you, Volek had to throw that one quickly. I mean, he was getting rushed. He was back there, and that thing came right out of there.
Kansas City with two timeouts plus the two-minute warning. Ball to the 23-yard line. First down. Green. Wobbler. May have been deflected, and it's incomplete. It's second down and 10.
Looked like Johnny Morton was pulling up. We're going to run a hook pattern, and Trent Green was ready for him to go deeper. He was throwing something over his head. Morton was running one pattern, Trent Green was throwing another.
Imagine if this game had playoff implications.
Yeah, wouldn't this be something?
Yeah.
If this game were a year ago, it would have.
Yeah. Second and 10 at the 23. That doesn't fool anybody, and then Richardson loses the football at the 17-yard line. Pump fake, draw. Richardson lost the ball. The officials are at the bottom of the pile.
Well, that's that play that both Kansas City and St. Louis has, where you fake the slant with that hand on the draw.
And the Tennessee Titans come up with a football.
Looked like Randy Starks got a lot of penetration on that play. So he's going to come back, and he fakes the slant. See right there, fake the slant, bring it back, then hand on the draw. And the minute he got the ball, Randy Starks was right there. Starks doesn't care about the fake. He just sees Green doesn't have it anymore, and he hits Richardson just as he gets the ball.
Recovery of a loose ball in the field of play, not challengeable. And how about Randy Starks, the rookie from Maryland, who in 35 minutes will celebrate his 21st birthday. He's the youngest player in the league.
You know, you ask Al before the game, 4-8, what's the game mean? How do they take it? If you look at the emotion and the passion on both of these sidelines, you know what the NFL is all about.
So in 3 seconds, the clock will stop, and then Kansas City will be put in a position to use their remaining timeouts on the other side of the two-minute warning on defense. Tennessee clearly already well within field goal range. Holcomb to the 15-yard line.
two-minute warning. 2 minutes remaining. 35-all. Monday Night Football being brought to you by Enterprise Rent-A-Car. Pick Enterprise and we'll pick you up. Lowe's, where you'll find all your home improvement needs. Lowe's improving home improvement. And T-Mobile, get more minutes, more features, and more service. Right after the game, the AutoTrader.com post-game show. But right now, the Tennessee Titans at the 15-yard line. A lot of candidates for the horse trailer tonight. Drew Bennett, Billy Volek, Larry Johnson.
Yeah, well, you can stop there with those first two, I think. I mean, they've been something special, and you muse about that now, but you also wonder about what happens here. I mean, Tennessee doesn't want to score too quickly because, you know, Kansas City still can score. Now, if you're Kansas City, do you do anything about that?
Well, you have to take your timeouts here because they have two. Otherwise, Tennessee can run it all the way down. Not all the way down, but close enough that Kansas City, without a timeout, would have next to no time. You're already in field goal range. So for the Chiefs, they are compelled to use their timeouts on defense.
I mean, I hate to say it. I hate to even bring it up, but do you let them score?
I don't think so.
Good.
Because you need a touchdown. Second and eight. Holcomb. They'll stop him here, take a timeout here, so that's 6 seconds gone. I don't think you let him score in a situation where you're going to have to go the length of the field.
Yeah, no, I agree with that.
And score 7 points.
You know, that's the other thing. You can say, you know, what do you do in this situation? If you're Tennessee, do you take another shot at the end zone before you go for the field goal, or do you just, you know, try and get the field goal? Because, as you say, now they have one timeout left, so they'll take it after this play.
The perfect scenario for Tennessee, of course, would be to get the ball inside the 7-yard line for a first down. And then take the clock all the way down and kick the field goal.
Right, and to do that, then you have to go to the pass. And if it's an incomplete pass, then that stops the clock. So that's the other thing that you ask here. On Tennessee's side, do they throw? And I would think that would be the play. And they've had that keeper, that bootleg all day since the first couple plays of the game. And I would expect that maybe they would go some kind of quarterback keeper or bootleg.
Concur. Third down and 7, 14-yard line, a minute and 54. Kansas City has one timeout. Bennett comes in tight. KC shows blitz. Flag is thrown. And Holcomb gets to the 9. Kavika Mitchell may have come across the line. May have been offside, the middle linebacker.
I think that's exactly what it was. Rico Mitchell getting up tight,
offside,
trying to hit that.
Number 50, defense, 5-yard penalty, remain, third down.
And not only that against Kansas City, but the clock is going to start with the snap.
See, Kawika Mitchell here, he's trying to hit that thing. He's trying to get up there tight and to hit that thing just as a ball snap. And in doing so, his right foot goes into neutral zone.
Third down and 2. Ball at the 9-yard line. Holcomb again. And they stack him up at the 8. And then Kansas City takes a timeout here. So that's their final timeout. Gary Anderson will come in to try to give them the lead by 3. And then there's plenty of time, of course, for the Chiefs on the other end, despite not having a timeout, to move the ball into field goal range.
And that's the first thing they'll try and do is you get a good kickoff return, move it into field goal range, you know, take a shot in the end zone, and then if you don't, kick the field goal. You know, because Jeff Fisher kicks so many onside kicks that the Kansas City Chief returns aren't strong. They've been in kind of an onside kick prevent all night. They haven't really set up many returns for Dante Hall. So I think if Tennessee makes a field goal here, I don't think there's any way that Jeff Fisher would onside kick. Do you?
I don't think so either.
So then if there's not, then you would think that Kansas City would have to get into a regular kickoff and try and get good field position.
That's according to Hoyle. With Fisher, you never know. 27-yard field goal attempt by Gary Anderson. Hendrick the hole, and that'll make it 38-35. So the irony here is that that was set up by the youngest player in the league, Randy Starks, who forced the fumble and recovered it, and cashed in by the oldest player in the league, Gary Anderson, on the field goal.
Andy Starks is something, isn't it? I mean, you come in this league at 20 years old, and you're playing against an offensive line like the Kansas City Chiefs.
And you're on Monday Night Football, and you make the big play of the game.
You're not even old enough to drink.
For another 28 minutes.
Right. Here's a fumble. See, it was that fake slant. Then when he brings the ball back to hand it to Richardson, Starks was right there. And then not only did he get right there and cause the fumble, but then he got on top of it. He recovered it. Fake slant, draw. Nope.
Starks is so young, he should be wearing diapers.
You see, this Kansas City kickoff return is still kind of an onside prevent. So they're not going to be in blocking position to get a good return.
Dante Hall, chance to run this one back from the three. Cuts to the outside. And is run out of bounds into the Titan bench up at the 36-yard line by Rich Gardner.
You know, that's where Jeff Fisher really bought something, you know, a week ago with those three onside kicks. That from that point on, the rest of the season, everyone is going to defend every kickoff as an onside kick. And somewhere in this drive, Tony Gonzalez is going to be a big part of it.
Three receivers set to the right. Trent Green to the air. Kansas City without a timeout. Tip and incomplete. Tip by Keith Bullock.
Yeah, I think the Titan defense was thinking the same thing. You know, when we talked to them, they said that they want to squeeze the middle. And you watch Tony Gonzalez here, but watch all the defenders as he goes into the middle. Look at all those Titans. They know that's where the Chiefs want to go. They want to go in the middle of the field. They want to go to Tony Gonzalez. And there are five defenders in that area.
Kansas City's kicker, Lawrence Tynes, his longest field goal of the year, 50 yards on the opener at Denver. Green throws, caught, Gonzalez flag. Boy, if it's a Tom White crew on a Monday night, there are a ton of flags. 17 accepted penalties tonight. God knows how many unaccepted.
Illegal contact. Number 42, defense. It's a 5-yard penalty and an automatic first down.
Scott McGarahan.
You know, the big thing on that is the automatic first down. You're going to see Scott McGarahan. He's a safety, the inside guy right there. And he gets the punch to the head of Johnny Morton.
First and 10, 41-yard line from the shotgun. Green over the middle. Johnson, Larry Johnson, reaches forward, gets up to the 48, second down. Keith Bullock makes the tackle, second and about four.
You know, another guy that's been quiet is Eddie Kennison. You'd think that there would be something to him outside.
Only one catch tonight, and that's incomplete, intended for Gonzalez. Kennison caught one for a touchdown for 58 yards early in the game, and that's been it. There's Tynes again, 50 yards, the longest kick for him this season.
Eddie Kennison ran a deep route over on that right side, and here on the third down play, he's not even in there.
Chris Horn in the game, number 81.
free play for Green, and that won't matter because Carlos Hall was offside.
And I think it's going to be enough for a first down,
it
too,
will
isn't
be.
It?
It was third and four. It's a first down at the 48-yard line.
Carlos Hall was a right defensive end. He's trying to get a jump here on Willie Rowe. Here he is right here.
Yep. Defense, the 5-yard penalty. This will be a first down.
You got to see Carlos Hall's fingers. I have no idea. In fact, I talked to him last night, and his hands and fingers are such a mess that there's no way that he can grab anything.
First and 10 at the 48-yard line. Green to the outside, caught, Horn makes the catch, and they get in field goal range now. He's at the 31 for a first down and out of bounds with 48 seconds.
This is where your offensive line comes in because you know you have to get the ball down the field, and it all starts here with pass protection. And look at the pass protection in that play that they give Trent Green. Like they gave Chris Horn, the receiver, just caught that ball. He had a pretty big cushion out there.
896 yards of total offense for the two teams tonight. And that's incomplete, intended for Johnny Morton with 45 seconds. First time in the history of this series, 35 years. Two consecutive games with each team scoring 30 or more. We had that great one last week in Seattle with Dallas coming from behind to win it. And tonight, 73 total points and almost 900 yards of offense. This is like the old AFL. Second down and 10. Green. Caught. Johnson, nice catch, but what else is new? A flag.
It was funny, I think Trent Green was trying to get to Tony Gonzalez. Tony Gonzalez was running a pattern, and Larry
personal
Johnson
foul.
Came right underneath him.
Roughing the passer, number 91, hit to the head, decided to head.
Travis LeBoy, another personal foul on him, the rookie from the University of Hawaii.
And again, he's the pass rusher, the speed guy, and you're going to see him come right there, right up the middle. You see it was his left arm out there. You see he's reaching, now watch his left arm come right there, and I don't know if that was the head or the shoulder. Boy, they're protecting the quarterbacks here tonight.
Second marginal call against LeBoy tonight.
LeBoy's probably thinking, what in the heck do I have to do, or what in the heck am I doing?
And Fisher's saying, well, wait a second. You're moving the ball now inside the 10-yard line? And that is the call on the personal foul. Because they had gotten to about the 25-yard line. Tack on 15.
Yeah, I don't know that if the blow weren't to the head, if it would have been legal, because I don't think it was a blow to the head.
First and goal now. Green, play fake, throws, caught, touchdown. Eddie Kennison, just talking about him, how silent he's been since he scored early in the game. And down the field go the Chiefs, not only to tie it, but to take the lead, and with an extra point force Tennessee to score a touchdown to win it.
He runs a corner pattern here on Andre Dyson. You see, he starts inside like he's going inside. Dyson takes the inside. Then Kennison goes to the corner, and as he makes his break, Dyson falls down. Boy, that's what you're looking for. If you can get a guy to play inside and you're going to run a corner, that's a gimme.
Tight with the extra point. Nice job by Steve Cheek on the low snap to put it down and make it a four-point Kansas City lead. And for Eddie Kennison, a chance now in back-to-back games to win the game at the end with a touchdown, as he did with about 2 minutes to go against Oakland last week.
Now, earlier I thought that Tennessee could be scoring too soon, which maybe they did because Kansas City, you know, can score so well. And now you wonder, did Kansas City score too soon?
Well, 32 seconds. Tennessee has one timeout. Let's go back again to the call. And as we mentioned, this crew notorious for a lot of penalties.
Well, he called that blow to the head. That wasn't a blow to the head. Now, whether that would have been legal and not be a late hit. See, he had thrown the ball, and then he was... calls it a late hit, then that could have been a late hit. If he calls it, you know, blow to the head, that wasn't to the head. Good play action pass, but the big thing on this touchdown was the move that Eddie Kennison made on Andre Dyson. When he got him inside and he knew he was going to go to the corner, that was a touchdown all the way.
Points in the game, and now 917 total yards in the game, and we ain't done.
Still got more football to be played here.
11 touchdowns. And the kickoff will settle into the arms of McGadley at the 9-yard line. Gets taken down up at the 31-yard line, so they'll have to go 69 yards in 24 seconds, and they can stop it once. So a Billy Volek's 418-yard night, with probably a few more to go to waste. Bennett, 12 receptions for 233.
Yeah, you wonder if Bennett has any more gas in his tank, or if Billy Volek has any more gas in that arm to keep throwing it.
Volek throwing into a seam, and that is Derek Mason. Chiefs say he didn't catch it. Officials say he did at the 45. They'll have to get up there and take their timeout right now, waiting for the call to be made. And the question now becomes, was this a catch? Take
a
look.
The timeout, it's one of those that they could look at for a long time. No, he didn't catch it.
No, and they're going to...
That ball hits the ground.
Going to go back to last week when we had the Keyshawn Johnson play, which should have been overturned. This has to be stopped by the gang upstairs. And they're going to stop it right now.
Had Billy Volek, though, gone up because he had the first down, gone up and spiked the ball, and then saved his timeout, he would have been better off because they wouldn't have been able to do this.
Well, there was some confusion on the play because there was no indication whether it was catch or no catch until 10 seconds had gone. They started at 24. Bennett bent over again. Combination of getting whacked and being exhausted, and you can see him really... grab and clutch.
Right, he's cramping up. You can just see that one cramp in the left leg. In fact, the left leg went into spasm.
White's going to go over and take a look and talk to the guys upstairs. Bennett really cramping here. If this is overturned, in other words, ruled an incomplete pass, then Tennessee will get its timeout back because they called their timeout predicated on the fact that it had been a complete pass. So they'll get the timeout back, but they won't get any time back on the clock.
I still think, I mean, it's easy to say what you could have done, what you should have done, but, you know, had they gone up, now, you know, when they ruled this a catch, just run up and spike it and then save your timeout. Now, with the timeout, they've given them a chance to challenge or to review,
which they are doing right now, and there are 14 seconds. What they'll do is they'll take a look at exactly how much time the play took until the incomplete pass, till the end of the play, if it's overturned, and then probably put about 3 seconds more, 3 or 4 seconds, onto the clock.
Yeah, we're always talking about guys playing hard and emptying their tank and giving everything they have, and I think those shots of Drew Bennett are showing that he's done that. I mean, there's nothing left. There's no gas left in that tank. There's very little fluid left in that body. Like I said, I mean, he was catching all those balls and running so many patterns, and they were all deep patterns too. I mean, if you would have put one of those, what do they call them, pedometers on him, I think he ran like 52 miles.
He had a great first quarter last week, 3 long touchdown grabs. intercepted penalties in the game tonight. It's 11:47 Central Time. Game started at about 8:08.
After reviewing the play, this is an incompleted pass. The ball will return to the previous spot, second down and 10, the 31-yard line, the Tennessee side of the field, and Tennessee gets their timeout back.
Now, what about any more seconds back? Apparently not. Technically, they could have gone back and looked at exactly how long that play took, because a couple of more seconds did go off the clock.
Before he called
the timeout.
Right, because he would have,
and there
they
it is.
Ruled incomplete pass. Yeah.
And that's what they've done now. As you can see, they go back to 19 seconds, so they did put five more seconds on the clock. So now it's 69 yards in 19 seconds, and they do have that timeout. So they were going to run that hook and ladder and all kinds of laterals and try to get it into the end zone, but Shad Meyer tried to toss it back, and it was dropped by Robert Holcomb, and then Mitchell picks it up and runs it into the end zone.
They were trying to do another one of those Miracle City... Music City Miracles. Look at that hit, and then Quico Mitchell's right there, as you say, to pick it up, and he just takes it in the end zone. I mean, that's one of those plays that look good in practice, and you have a guy handling or pitching a ball who doesn't do it, then it ends up very, very ugly.
And Tynes for the extra point, and that will cement it for Kansas City. Still a kickoff to come, and it's 49-38.
Now, there's a guy with a smile that says he's going to be back next year.
Carl Peterson coming down to give him a big hug.
You know, it's funny, you come into the game 4-8, you say it doesn't mean anything, it's a meaningless game, there's no playoff implication, but you just look at the faces and the emotions and the passions of the players, and you know that every time you play a game, it does mean something.
Kansas City early tonight trailed 14-0. Didn't take the lead until about the midway mark of the fourth quarter. And a much happier ride home to Kansas City tonight coming up for the Chiefs, who will go to 5-8. Believe it or not, they are still mathematically alive for a playoff berth. And Tennessee will be officially eliminated, as if you didn't know.
But, you know, I still think that there's still, like I said, there's still games, and these guys are players, and when there is a game to be played, you just want to play, and you want to win. I mean, it's still about going out there and giving everything you have to win, and maybe they are eliminated, but these guys are going to be back next week playing tough with what they have.
Famous words of Herm Edwards, you play to win the game.
Right. You got 16 of them, you play all 16 that way.
Tynes' kickoff fielded at the 20-yard line. The ball is just dumped off by Jason McCandley, and that's the way the game will end. And, of course, it will end with a flag.
There's a flag.
You know, there are two flags.
It's an illegal forward pass during the return. Penalty declined. Ball game's over.
Jeez. Amen. Green Bay and Washington at 83 combined for 95 points, most in the history of Monday Night Football, second most tonight. 87 total points as the Kansas City Chiefs beat the Tennessee Titans 49-38. And coming up next, the AutoTrader.com postgame show when we return to Nashville.